I'm going to call this meeting to order, so if everyone would please take any conversations outside, that would be very helpful. Good evening, and welcome to the Monday, February 6th, 2017, Select Board meeting being held in the Town Room at Town Hall at 6:34 p.m. There should be copies of the agenda in the back of the room. There are a large number of items on our agenda tonight, so we will be trying to move at a fairly rapid pace. Is there anything the Select Board needed to bring to my attention in terms of the agenda tonight? Or the Town Manager? Thank you. Excellent. And so we are going to dive right in. We normally have the press with us, although I suspect they might be elsewhere in town tonight. And we are definitely being taped and broadcast by Amherst Media, which you can watch later, as always, so thank you to them. And we are going to start with public comment. Now, the way public comment works, for those of you who may not have joined us in the past, is that if it's an agenda item, meaning it's on that agenda in the back of the room under action and discussion items or licenses, et cetera, then that's not being covered during the public comment period. So if there's anything that's not on this agenda that someone was here to speak during public comment, if you could please raise your hand so that I would know that, so we'd have a sense of how long public comment needs to be. Yes, you have something that's not related to the agenda, sir? Okay, and is there anyone else who has anything? Okay, well then it looks like we just have one this evening on a non-agenda topic. If you would please come forward, sir. Once you get settled in at the mic, please feel free to push the keyboard out of the way since we're not doing a presentation right now, so you can get the mic nice and close and identify yourselves for the folks at home.
So Vince O'Connor, Precinct 1, town meeting member, and I'm here to express a concern regarding the, we have yet to hear any public or see anything in writing about whatever progress has been made in getting the university to pay for the cost of the especially the 45 to 50 elementary students that it sends to the Amherst schools each year, which is a number I think that probably is greater than all of the colleges other colleges in Massachusetts send to the elementary schools in the towns in which they are located, simply because most schools do not have the kind of family housing arrangement that Amherst, that UMass does. And that doesn't take into account, of course, students from UMass who may attend the Chinese immersion school or who school choice out of Amherst to another school district. So that's my first concern. My second concern is I think everyone admires the efforts of the town officials in the past, I think decade really, to secure meaningful contributions for ambulance service. We still have yet to get from any of the large nonprofit institutions contributions for fire protection. I think it's an important thing, and this could be the source, from my perspective, of the money necessary to increase our staffing in the fire department and EMT, and could allow us, in my opinion, to have a third fire station appropriately located in South Amherst. The final concern that I have regarding the matter of obtaining more funds to support the town's services is the fact that Amherst College, both in comparison to other universities and colleges in Boston, Williams College, and so forth, does not make a meaningful contribution, and I think it is most important to understand that that in fact all of the dormitories of Amherst College were once fraternities, until they were bought out in the early 80s by Amherst College, when they proved to be not consistent with the college's co-ed direction. And as a result, those fraternities became dormitories, which fulfilled the Amherst colleges and were part of the Amherst College educational mission. And as such, they became tax exempt officially, but Amherst College did a 100%, 80%, 60%, 40%, et cetera, declining block payment. If those institutions, which surround our downtown and so forth, were still taxpaying, we would be receiving hundreds of thousands, if not over $1 million in taxes. And I think that that's an appropriate amount for the town to be shooting for. And I think it is really, since the 1980s, one of the sources, along with the university, of the town's structural deficit. A deficit that is not unique to Amherst, but is basically consistent with the kind of deficits that are run by other communities that have large educational institutions and other nonprofit entities in it that do not make consequential payments in lieu of taxes. So that's my concern. I would hope and ask that the select board and the town manager prepare some kind of presentation in writing so that as we enter into the budget season, people can be aware of what progress is being made on these matters. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we established earlier that there was no public comment not related to an item, that there was not any public comment that was unrelated to any item on our agenda. So we are going to skip past town manager report and select board member reports for now. We will come back to committee appointments later on in the evening, and we will move into section 6, the action and discussion items. The first item listed is local access contract Amherst Media update, and it's dated 12-1 because that's the last time we had a substantive update on that. And I just need to go over where we're at associated with this beyond the December 1st last discussion we had. So the first thing I want to do is make sure it's clear that everyone's aware that I still have on file a disclosure of an appearance of a conflict of interest back from March of 2015, referring to the fact that my spouse, Stephen Brewer, an employee of UMass Amherst, is not only a member of the Amherst Media Board of Directors, but currently serves as president. However, he has no financial interest in Amherst Media, and there is not actually a financial conflict. However, given that we are now past the Comcast stage and that we are moving into the Amherst Media stage, while I am still organizing the meeting, when it comes to anything that might seem to someone to be deliberation on a contract with Amherst Media, I want to make sure I take myself out of that conversation. So here's how things are going to look tonight. We are going to have a presentation from the town manager. There will then be time for the select board to ask questions of the town manager and discuss issues among themselves. I believe Stephen Brewer intends to make a statement shortly after that. There is going to be time for a statement from Jim Lesko, the Amherst Media Executive Director. There will also be a statement from Deesha Baz, who served both as recent chair of our Cable Advisory Committee and still serves on the Amherst Media Board. We definitely made time for Isaac Ben Ezra, our former select board representative to the board, to have a chance to talk. And so those are all the things that are going to be happening. I am going to be leaving the room while all those things are happening, and I am going to, on my way out of here, put a bunch of handouts in the back of the room. There probably aren't enough for everyone, but it will give you a sense of the materials that we're working from that we've just received. There's an RFP process for PEG services, which was in fact in our online packet. For those of you following along at home, you've probably seen that already. There was an amendment to the agreement with Amherst Media. I will also be putting that in the back of the room, and also the IGR release. So see those handouts if you haven't seen them already. And Mr. Slaughter is going to take over from here, Amherst Media, so you can focus on him. And then I will come back in the room once this section is over. So thank you.
Thank you. So just to get started, one of the other things that we'll do is, you know, we have a series of people that Ms. Brewer just sort of listed off. They're likely to speak. At that point, I'll probably ask to see who else would like to comment on it. I would suggest we'll probably only take 3 minutes for each person's opportunity to speak to us, but I'll get a sense of how many people are wanting to speak to it at that point. And also, you know, feel free to not speak if you choose not, you know, balance whether your points have been made by other people or not. And so don't feel like if you raise your hand that you absolutely have to, you can always back out later. Don't want to be compelled to that. I will try to keep people fairly tight on time just because we have a few things and I'm perceiving that there might be several people that are interested in that, but we'll do a quick tally of who's interested in speaking when we get to that point and sort of see where we're at. But we'll start out with the manager first, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. As I reported to you earlier, there's an agreement between the Town of Amherst and Amherst Community Television, which is Amherst Media, that was first executed on February 16th, 2007. The contract was retroactive to October 11th, 2006. In essence, it expired on the same date as the expiration of the cable license buy-in between the town of the town and Comcast, which was October 11th, 2006. This contract with Amherst Media expired on October 15th, 2016, which is when we renewed our contract with Comcast. Now, under the normal procedures, we would have entered into negotiations with Amherst Media, or which I'll say instead of Amherst Community Television Inc., so everybody knows what I'm talking about, and have executed a contract. But the rules of the game changed, and we have had to comply with new rules issued by the state. In the meantime, the town continues to honor all terms and conditions of the contract, including all payments to Amherst Media. And Amherst Media continues to honor all terms and conditions of the contract, including recording town government meetings such as this. And I'm grateful for Amherst Media's cooperation during this period. There is no change in any terms of this business relationship. So first, some background. In January of 2016, over a year ago, the Massachusetts Department of Revenue, Division of Local Services, issued IGR 16-102, which is in the back of the room, which requires the town to account for PEG fees in a different way than we had in the past. We reviewed this guidelines with our auditing firm, Melanson Heath, and with our Department of Revenue representative. This is before my time. This is I didn't start until August, so this is during the summer of 2016. We asked explicitly if we could simply continue as we had in the past, since we viewed the funds as a pass-through and were not on our balance sheet at year-end. Both parties, the auditor and the Department of Revenue, rejected this approach and said we would need to comply effective July 1, 2017 for fiscal year 2018. They allowed us basically a year to get this ready. In my FY18 budget presentation, I presented the revenue for PEG, the estimated revenue for PEG from Comcast as a local receipt. And I have budgeted an equivalent expenditure on the expense side of the budget. The goal is to replicate our existing business relationship with Amherst Media. In short, we are working to find a way to ensure that the designated funds received by the town from Comcast can be transmitted in whole to the organization awarded the bid. Unfortunately, complying with the law means that because we have money coming in, we can't just send it out. We need to follow procurement laws and publicly bid for the services that Amherst Media has been providing for the town for 40 years. This is a significant change in our past practice. We contacted the Inspector General's office to see if this category was exempt in any way. They said it was not. We are required to follow the state's procurement laws. We then asked if Amherst Media could be considered an intergovernmental agency of the town, but the answer was that they are not and could not be treated that way. That would have allowed us to transfer the funds automatically. So, seeing that this is the lay of the land, we are preparing a request for proposals which will move this process forward so that a contract will be finalized as soon as practicable and our accounting will be in compliance by July 1, 2017. I will assemble a committee to review the proposal that will include our procurement officer, our IT director, a member of the select board, and we will request the presence of the select board's Amherst Community Television board liaison. We have set a proposed timeline. The final timeline will be distributed upon the release of the RFP. But right now we're looking at, we would advertise the RFP on February 28th. We would ask for proposals to be delivered to the town by March 17th. We would review the proposals the week of March 20th. and hopes to make a final decision by March 29th and have a contract signed by April 14th. In the meantime, I've offered a contract extension on the exact same terms and conditions to Amherst Media through June 30th, 2017 to secure any concern that Amherst Media has about the existing relationship. So that's my report.
Right, thank you, Chair. Are there questions from Select Board specifically for the manager or comments?
I do have some comments, and then I have a question for the manager. But I first wanted to start by making a general comment, because I've been one of the two people who was designated by the Select Board to work with the manager on this project, and the lead person to work with manager on this project, which I have been doing. In that regard, I want to just start out by saying that the Select Board very much appreciates Amherst Media in all respects, including Amherst Media's right for free speech and to express its opinions, and it has an avenue to do so, which is above and beyond most members of the community, because it is a media outlet, and so it has used its media, including a stream on the bottom of the town meeting presentation of last week's town meeting, to start stating its opinion. Of course, while respecting that right, I'm distressed by several things. I think that there have been a number of inaccurate statements made or misleading statements that have been made, and the creation of fear that is unwarranted amongst a large number of members of the public that something has been intended or inadvertently will have the result of somehow damaging a very valuable institution, which is the institution to provide public access, education, and government programming, and that it flies in the face of decades of working relationship between the town and Amherst Media. And I think that it was unnecessary that happened. We appreciate the fact, as noted by the manager, that Amherst Media has continued to provide programming on channels 12, 15, and 17. And the town has, as also noted, continued to provide funding as in the past, as it comes in from Comcast to Amherst Media. The town, as also noted, offered to extend the written contract. But the fact of the matter is a couple of things. We can't ignore the fact that the Department of Revenue issued the regulation IGR 16102, that it does specifically state that there are two mechanisms. We appreciate the fact that the director of Amherst Media has come and suggested that there might be another approach to take. We have not seen that from conversations with either the Department of Revenue or with our accountant sets up a viable mechanism. And so we need to proceed with the reality of what the law provides to us, which is the RFP process that has been recommended. The other thing that I would note is that we met last week, Mr. Slaughter and I, who are the two Select Board people who are the designated people to work with the town manager on this, with two members of the board for about an hour, the Amherst Media board for about an hour and a half, talked about a variety of topics. And one of the things we pointed out was that it's not unprecedented in Massachusetts to have RFPs for the issuance of PEG services, and that there are two towns, which we provided the names of, that have existing contracts with their PEG provider through an RFP process, and that it has been, from all we can detect, worked very smoothly in the issuance of the contract, the execution of the contract, and the provision of services. And all of that information, we hope that everybody recognizes, because this idea that something horrible happens with RFPs, as is evident from all of the buttons that are around the room that say slash no RFP, is creates this impression that it is somehow an unacceptable mechanism for procurement, when it is a standard required mechanism for procurement, and one that has been used in this very circumstances in other Massachusetts communities with great success and without problems for either the PEG provider or for the community. So turning to my question for the manager, I assume that since these the group that you're asking for to meet with to provide advice on the contract is only advisory in nature, that it is not a problem to have a member of the Amherst Media Board of Directors as a participant in that process, but our liaison to Amherst Media is a member of their board of directors and has the requirements of a member of the board. So it's not a question that needs to be responded to immediately, but before you do that, I would urge that that issue be just confirmed, that that given the nature of how you want to use this group, that that in fact is not a problem. And so thank you.
Connie?
Well, thank you, Mr. Steinberg. I think you raised some really good points, and I just wanted to add, because I've said this in prior meetings a little bit when we've discussed this, I've done a lot of work with requests for proposals, not in this context, more around development, procuring consultants, and housing development projects, and I actually support the request for proposal process because I think it helps the town in clarifying what it's looking for, and it's an important statement about the direction we're going with our media services. That's not to say about controlling the broadcast or the free speech issues, but I find the request for proposal not a threatening process. It takes a little bit of work to craft it, but I think a useful exercise. And so I was taken aback that this was perceived as a hostile measure, because I think I saw this as a sort of normal course of business and one that could be good for the town and perhaps including good for the Amherst Media or the awardee of the contract. So I hope that people understand we're entering into this process in good faith, and the manager has done a very thorough job of seeing what the legal options were, or the regulatory options, and I think we're proceeding. We have a little bit of a broader responsibility than just one vendor or one contractor. We're trying to keep the town in good standing and in good compliance with lots of requirements that we face all the time.
So if there aren't any other questions for the manager or comments that need to be made from the select board at this point, if Mr. Brewer would like to come up and make his comment, please.
Thank you. I'm Stephen Brewer. I'm the president of the Board of Amherst Media. I'm also the husband of Ms. Brewer, who's the chair of the select board. And I wanted to take just a brief moment to explain something that I think is important for people to understand. As with my wife, I wanted to, when the town, when Amherst Media entered into negotiations with the town, I thought it was important to recuse myself to avoid the appearance of a conflict of interest, and had discussed doing that in consultation with the board. And for that purpose, I have delegated to the executive committee of Amherst Media the responsibility of representing Amherst Media in these negotiations. And I wanted to make clear that my lack of participation in the negotiation or making public statements was not misconstrued as taking any kind of position on the activities of the organization during this process.
Thank you. And at this point, if Mr. Lesko could come up, and I believe.
I guess Mr. Bennett, they.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
So we can, Isaac is here to speak, and he'll have to leave soon.
Right.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
Change order here.
Yeah, that's all right. And just as a reminder, if you'll make sure to state your name.
Good evening. I'm Isaac Benezra. I've been your representative, that is, representative select board, on the board of Amherst Media, formerly known as ACTV, for 9 years. Nobody gets to be appointed for 9 years in the town that I, unless they're crazy. But I have to say that in my retirement, it has been a wonderful, wonderful marital relationship, and I almost felt, I have to say this to get it off my chest, when I heard about, we don't want a divorce, but we want to look at other opportunities, as a form of mediation. So can you blame me for feeling that way? I feel jilted because the relationship that I've enjoyed with the town and its representatives have been one of working together. So I feel like the bride that's being told, you know, you've done a good job, but I got to look around. And I think you need to look at what we have before you look around, because you might say to yourself, gee, what's keeping her from leaving the relationship, let alone being having the feeling that we're going to be scrutinized. And because I don't look at this as a one of conflict, I have to start out by saying, I love you guys. I'm not here to fight. I'm here to protect something that we have worked so hard to develop. And I've been fortunate to be on the board and to represent the select board for 9 years. And I have to tell you, there was an attempt 10 years ago to make ACTV a subcommittee of one of the groups in the town. And I think it's the recreation department. Everybody was to hand in their resignation. I just came onto the board, and there were one, and they're leaving. I'm not having a lot of luck, but fortunately, I believed in what we were doing, and smarter and more thoughtful heads prevail. So now whatever happens down the road, I want you to know the only thing I'm interested in my retirement is to see the young people and the old people and the people in the community who have been participating in making ACTV what it is continue to be what it is. And I'm glad to hear that we shouldn't worry about the future. Well, I have to tell you, as a former mediator, divorce mediator, when I hear somebody say that, that makes me worry, because it means that maybe I'm not doing so good. So I would ask you to investigate your relationship with us a little more deeply. Maybe it's we've lost We've lost touch with each other. We've gone our separate ways, and new people come in, and I can't blame them. They don't have a history. But the people around this table have a history. Everybody has been a participant for a long time. And I say that, and I just want to wind up by saying this. See this contract that we've been living in for 10 years? Check out. It has my name on it. President. And Jasna Rej as our reporter, the manager at the time, Lawrence Schaefer. You know, Lawrence Schaefer came in, he was new too. And the first thing he did was to get to know us. And I think that I would welcome that we find ways of making it part of the process of getting to know us. And that might help to realize what a gem we have. One that's revered by this whole town. And one other thing, it's very hard to get good people. We are blessed with the kind of staff that we have. We're working on a minimum budget with a minimum amount of people. And when you say that we're looking around in this job market, now is the time for them to jump. We've had we've been training people. They've gone to CBS, NBC. It's a shame that we don't pay enough to keep them. But one of the things we should be talking about is why can we bring more resources so we can keep the people we've trained who are members of this community. Now, I'm going to finalize because I know you have a big budget. But if you look at this contract was developed not by lawyers getting together, but two people from ACTV, the late Paulette Brooks, and myself, who got our own lawyer, and then we sat down with the manager, and he came in with another plan, which would have made us a subcommittee of the recreation department. And I said, who are you negotiating with? That's what I told Schaefer. And he said, with you. I said, well, then let's talk about our contract that we have now and build the things that we think we need to add. And so that was a partnership from the beginning. And for years, I met with Lawrence every 2 weeks for lunch, and we talked about issues. That's why I became the town representative. Now, if I wasn't doing a decent job, you either would neglect and not paying attention to my responsibilities to you, or I was doing a good job, but you didn't have time. You didn't have to worry about what was going on. But we've never stolen a nickel. Everything's been audited. We have a community by the hundreds that have come into that place, young and old, and we have created a gem. And I think it's not a matter of assuring us that we'll be okay until June. If you have any idea what it is to recreate this, let us know. Let the community know. But I think we're acting not defensively, but we're acting to protect the interests of the town, and we need to put our heads together to resolve this quickly, not to continue to have this kind of stuff going on. And you'll forgive me, I have to leave because my handlers say I can't hang around too long. Thank you for hearing.
Thank you.
Thank you for representing.
Thank you.
There'll be no outcries.
Okay, I'll just move out of your way. I know you know how to drive. Okay.
What's that? I'm sorry.
Yeah,
so I'll
yeah.
Be next.
That's perfectly fine.
So
So hello, my name is Demetria Shabazz, and I'm not only the VP of the board for Amherst Media, I'm also a faculty member at UMass in the Department of Communication. So give me one moment. So thank you, town manager, for your attention to our contractual needs. I have communicated your offer to the board about the extended contract that arrived Friday afternoon at 4:30. We have not had an opportunity to look at it. However, February the 11th, we will be meeting, and I'm sure the extension that you're offering will be topic of conversation. So first, I'd like to address my response to the offer that you have sent to us. Just real quick, Chair Brewer said if I went over 3 minutes to ask for more time, it might be about four. I will try to be brief. But the reason why I am asking for at least another minute is that I think what has happened is that there's lots of confusion and things have gotten a bit convoluted. So first, the memo also given today by the town manager to the select board has set up and proposed a timeline and next steps for the contract. This memo has as the person to assist in the process Adrian Terezzi, which is the town's liaison, and I've told Adrian this after serving with her on the Cable Advisory Committee. I will go with her anywhere and we will be in war together, but because I have so much faith in her abilities and what she's able to do, I think it is unfair to split her position in terms of representing either the select board or will she represent Amherst Media. Yeah. And I can say after working with her on the CAC, she tries to look after both the town's interest and Amherst Media, and not having representation of Amherst Media on any committee that will decide our fate, I think is a misstep. Okay, so in addition, in negotiations past, community members have provided review of contracts regarding the Access Center, and this RFP process would circumvent that. After going through the ascertainment process and seeing how the subscribers and people of the town really feel positively about the services that we provide. They had lots of criticism for Comcast, but for us, they really had faith in what we were able to deliver for the last 10 years. I would again hate to circumvent that process by putting in place RFP or an enterprise fund that does not allow for the input of the community members. The other item that I wish to raise tonight concerns a need for clarification regarding the information you've presented pertaining to the RFP. You've also discussed town manager in the media, the first article appearing December 26, and in various meetings held with the executive director, Jim Lesko, Ed Severance, Adrian Terezzi, Stephen Brewer, and myself. There seems to be a bit of confusion regarding the requirement that you have articulated as this request for proposal or a setup of an enterprise fund for payment of services to Amherst Media. As the board of Amherst Media, we have been really immersed in these documents pertaining to enterprise funds, RFPs, etc., for some time. And it has become clear that what you are presenting as a requirement and as a required change from our vantage point and from our research is a recommendation. Historically, enterprise funds and RFP processes for access centers emerged as a means of making sure that access centers were paid by municipalities that, for whatever reason, commingled their funds or misappropriated them. However, we have faith that this has not occurred, and we have worked in partnership with you. So these guidelines were meant not necessarily to determine or require that the towns pay through an RFP for the access pay the access centers through an RFP, but it was meant as an option. And I think the language within the informational guideline release for January 2016, under the summary, the third paragraph, kind of illustrates that this is a guideline and not a requirement. So just an example, and I'm reading one of the very short paragraphs here. Cities and towns may now designate cable PEG access operations or services as an enterprise or separately account for all franchise fees and other revenues derived from enterprise activities in the same manner as other enterprise funds. And throughout this document, it stipulates guidelines and it says may do this. And it doesn't say they are required. Furthermore, Mass Access, which is our policy group within the state of Massachusetts, advises us that if we are already receiving direct payment and there isn't a problem with direct payment, again, it's for misappropriation, mishandling of funds, that we should continue that process. So again, this is a choice. We would like to offer you that if you revisit, and I'm so glad to see Isaac bringing up the 2007-2006 contract as our starting point and recognize how constructive our relationship has been in bringing services to the town of Amherst consistently. We have provided you services at, if we look at our report that we gave to you a couple of weeks ago, you can see all the many hours that our staff and our volunteers have provided in terms of services having to do with education, government, and public. Looking at the next 10 years, how might we think and plan to go forward? The positive reasons I think we should look at. Why we as a board support the continued direct payment option is that it ensures continued stability, excellence, and responsiveness to community above all. And that's kind of been our mantra, providing excellence, stability, and services, responsiveness of services above all. This arrangement has allowed us autonomy, yes, something that we value, and an independence in terms of services that we provide that are transparent and that when needed, we are always there to serve. Indeed, we have gone beyond whatever was stipulated within our 2006 contract, placing the town always at the highest priority. Based on our knowledge of other communities around the country with RFPs, Andy Steinberg points out, you know, I appreciate that. Again, we've done our research. Since about 2006, actually, beginning on the West Coast in California, when RFPs and enterprise funds were introduced, so went those access stations. One of the best examples is Austin Access in the state of Texas, my home state. Austin Access had one of the most successful access centers, fully networked within the town. Once RFPs were introduced, a film group took it over. Nothing against film people, I study film. But the public part and the government part of Access Austin went away. Now it's run by a bunch of folks who are into film. Wonderful. But that's not an access center. That's not a center that invites the public in to have their own shows, to have their own voice, really, be shared with others in the community. That's not a place where you get government transparency. Okay? So I'm going to wind this up. So for us, we have nothing monetary to gain in this endeavor. But as consumers, citizens of Amherst and of the Commonwealth, we wish only to continue to make available the means for others to produce their shows, have transparency in terms of the government, and remain informed regarding their community. So I just want to end with, if it ain't broke, why fix it? And if we try to fix something that does not need repair, however, we may do more harm than good and go the way of other access centers that are no longer here. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sorry? I would prefer, it's kind of like town meeting, for those of you that watch town meeting, we prefer not to have sort of applause at statements, but you know, we're trying to acquire information, do our work here, and so we'll try to refrain from expressions of support or dismay or those sort of things, if you would, please. Thank you. Jim, if you would.
Certainly. My name is Jim Lesko. I'm the executive director of Amherst Media, and thank you for allowing us this time to address you. I'd like to first thank the both Isaac and Demetria for coming in and speaking tonight, and all the others that have shown up that would like to show their support. Also, we've received numerous emails in support of what we do. I believe the town has also received some. I'd like to recap. I'm not going to really go into great detail because I've sent you many things in writing. I've been before you before, so I would just like to recap, okay, if I may. And this is in regard to what we, the community here, is as IGR16-102, which sounds like some kind of space shot. But there's more options out there. I've said this before, you just heard, but there's also exists that option that cable companies directly fund the PEG provider, in this case it would be Amherst Media. The funding mechanism is currently being implemented in 17 Western Mass communities. As select board members, you have never acknowledged this existing option being utilized in neighboring Northampton, Holyoke, Springfield, Deerfield, and 13 others. But the town manager continues to put forth written material to you and to the media as though the town is being forced by the Department of Revenue with no other alternatives. Recently, we were told to look at the towns of Lexington and Concord to see what the RFPs look like, since our town officials are using those for guidance. I did just that. Lexington's RFP was formulated 13 years ago when the town decided to start a community access center instead of the one historically run by the cable company. This process is always used when initiating a new access center. Reminder, as a nonprofit organization, we have been servicing this community for 41 years. In Amherst, the select board is the cable licensing issuing authority for the cable contract. In Concord, the town manager has full control. Concord's town manager is currently moving forward to making the once independent nonprofit PEG Access Center into a municipal department. Obviously, neither of these two examples makes me feel any better about an RFP. My two questions for the select board are these. Are you voting tonight, or have you voted previously on instituting the town manager's proposed new procurement procedure? If I could get an answer, I'd appreciate that. Are you voting tonight, or have you voted previously on instituting the town manager's proposed new procurement procedure?
Have you voted on it?
You haven't, I take it, or?
No, we haven't voted on it in the past. I mean, we've only had it in a couple of meetings, but.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I was under the impression we could have a dialogue. I'm sorry. No, it's a question.
Just to sort of clarify, I think that, the procurement rules, as far as that goes, are dictated by state law and are generally under the purview of the manager. So we don't generally take a vote. So he procures a service, like we'll hear about later on tonight. He procured a third party to provide some support around a different topic that's on our agenda this evening. We weren't involved in that process because that's still under his purview in that regard. Obviously, in things of a higher visibility, we'll suggest our advice, we'll work our way through it. But we have not taken any sort of formal vote.
Okay.
I guess is the simplest answer.
I'm sorry.
Connie, if you would, real quick, if you want to.
I might have reacted prematurely, but from where I sit, we're looking to our town manager to advise us, and certainly have had lots of opportunities to hear input, other opinions about how statutory requirements might affect us. But I very much look to the manager for that. We haven't actually discussed, maybe the negotiating group has more, our preferences or balancing. But I think it's absolutely appropriate as a select board member for me to look to the manager to filter the information and make that recommendation. It's a different kind of standing than an informed opinion of potential applicant in a RFP process. And my understanding about Lexington and Concord is we're talking about RFP as to form. Here's a form, a format to look at, to structure something if you're gonna go the RFP route. I'm not sure, the fact that their end result or their situations are different. I would like us to have that kind of dialogue, and I feel like we're squaring off. And as much as that's just how I feel. Maybe it's the couple hundred emails we've been bringing that to this, and I'll try to let that go. But I don't think we're doing something out of the ordinary or particularly offensive, but it is appropriate for us to look to the manager for advice.
Absolutely. So anyway, go ahead.
If I may.
Yep.
Thank you for the clarifications. And I'm very close to wrapping up. The town manager told Amherst Media personnel at a meeting that he had asked one of the select board members to see if the town could run the PEG channels. He was told that yes, there's enough money for two people to run it for the town, but the town manager stated he didn't feel that the town was ready yet. Yet, perhaps the time will be right for the town manager and the town of Amherst when in 3 years the RFP must go out to bid again. I will not highlight again for you the many services beyond government coverage we do for the community organizations and the residents. That was highlighted for you in our annual report. I will not repeat the number of 188 meetings we covered or the number of hours our intern staff and members worked to provide you that coverage. But I guarantee you, no two town employees could ever service all of the community as the independent Amherst Media does every day and has done for the past 41 years. I believe you still can change the course you're on. I believe that you can immediately initiate contract negotiations with Amherst Media, and I encourage you to consider so. Thank you.
Thank you. I think at this point, let me see if, so we've heard from a few folks. Are there others in the audience that would like to speak and add public comment? And again, I would suggest we're looking for information that would be new. That you haven't sent us to via email. So if you just have a quick show of hands to see how many folks are interested. All right, 1, 2, 3. So I've got 3 on this side, and it looks like 4 on this side. And I'll start on this side. We'll take about 3 minutes. I'd like you to keep it to about 3 minutes. I'll be a little firmer on time than we were with the previous speakers. Only, yeah, you don't have to take 3 minutes, obviously. But I mean, but obviously also if someone sort of states the same thing you were planning on saying, that's, you know, you can defer and just state that quickly and we can go to the next person. So we'll start on this side. If you would want to come up, just state your name at the microphone and give us your remarks, please.
My name is Gabriel Cifuentes. I'm from the city of Chicopee. I used to be an intern with Amherst Media, and this is why I'm here to speak to you today. First of all, I'd like to say thank you for having me. And I also want to say that I'm very grateful that we have the ability to have transparency in this room. There's something that concerns me, and I think this is something that hasn't been mentioned before, is the way that the dialogue is happening in this room right now. I heard that there was this culture of fear from you guys, that you believe that Amherst Media is overstating the facts, if you will. But what I didn't hear from you guys is why you believe that our discussion about RFPs is fearful. I didn't understand how it actually will benefit Amherst Media. That is not something I heard in this room tonight. What also concerns me is that one of the select board men believes that receiving emails from the public is some sort of confrontation as opposed to a dialogue. That truly, truly is very worrisome, because from what I'm hearing from this side of the room is that this is supposed to be a partnership between the city of Amherst and the people that it represents. And it doesn't just represent the people of Amherst. Like I said, I am from Chicopee. I've lived in Holyoke. I've lived in Northampton. I've lived in Agawam. But Amherst Media has always been there for me. As an immigrant, it has given me a voice that has not been offered in a lot of other ways. And I think that in what we're seeing in this country right now is the pocket of people that get to have a voice is growing smaller and smaller. And we're seeing that in the media, but we're also seeing that in the loss of public spaces. And so we can't just see Amherst Media as what it offers digitally. We have to see what it offers in the physical sense, where it has the ability to congregate all sorts of people from the community so that they can communicate with each other and offer a multitude of voices, because I truly believe that a monoculture of thought is destructive to any sort of community. I also found it interesting that the city of Austin was mentioned earlier today, because we have to realize how Amherst Media can be beneficial to the economy of Amherst as well. If it offers the ability to create an identity in the town, and that's what it did in Austin. It helped a lot of artists expose themselves, and it's what has allowed that city to be so vibrant. And so I think I'll conclude with that, but thank you very much.
Thank you. That was exactly 3 minutes, by the way. So on this side, who was next on this side? You're in the front, or if you would please. You can please state your name and
my name is Kathleen Lynch. I'm the executive director of East Hampton Media. East Hampton Media serves the city of East Hampton. We also serve the town of Southampton with the select board. In addition to that, my experience, I also count to my experience being a member of the Montague Cable Advisory Committee. That was possibly the most unpleasant experience I've ever had in my life. And let me tell you why. This is the issue. RFP. And so I understand RFP in how it relates to the procurement law. I understand everyone in municipal government wants to do their due diligence. I do not believe it applies in this area. I think that RFPs are intended for new things or for changes of things, for changes in services. For example, should the performance evaluation of the Access Center come up wanting and the town chooses not to renew that contract, would then at that point put out an RFP for service. There's been a lot of buzz in municipal administration about the Enterprise Fund. I've been hearing about it already for 2 years. Let's not get too excited about it, because I have a really strong feeling that there's an addendum law that addresses specifically what we're talking about here coming down the pike, because 30B was supposed to have this addendum law with it, and our legislature failed to pass that measure in package. Now, I want you to understand that as a person who is not from this community but interacts with this community a lot, I drive through here, I dump a ton of money into the restaurants here, my kids went to school down the street, they don't anymore. I want you to understand that Amherst being the kind of community that it is, and the national climate being the kind of climate that it is, this particular issue gains exceptional relevance because it happens here in Amherst. And I want the municipality to try and understand that there is, in this day and age, no issue that can happen around the people's right and access to free speech that will not engender civil rights issues. And now feels, honestly, in this community, not the time to fight this battle. It does not feel like it is the time to fight this battle. It feels to me like an incredible display of leadership would be to extend a magnanimous branch from the administrative office and try to work it out with our nonprofits, who have already sunk an incredible amount of time, energy, resourcing, and intellect to secure an excellent contract, much better contract for the citizens and for the town of Amherst than probably you would have gotten on your own. And I want you to try to look at these relationships with the nonprofits, and especially nonprofits that you partner with, as true partnerships, because you serve each other, and if it's a good partnership, you're serving each other well. I do not believe that the 30B restrictions require you to put out an RFP at this time, and I really urge you to do that. In addition, I also have a prepared statement that I know was emailed into the board today. And
if,
I would like to
if you
read
could finish
it.
Up, please. Or
It's a separate person who has a stomach flu and couldn't be here today. Can I read it into the record? It's short.
It's already a part of the record. If it was emailed to us, we'll have it as a part of our record.
Okay, well then, this is from a former municipal leader of 16 and a half years who is asking you to do the right thing, and please examine that. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you. So if you would, please.
Hi, I'm Sarah Little Kress. I'm a resident of North Amherst. Myself and my husband, Matthew King, we choose to live in Amherst and pay Amherst taxes because of the services that our taxes buy. And that was really important to us. It was important to us for wanting to raise our families here. It's important as far as long-term, really wanting to be part of this community for decades. A couple of questions that I have. Of the 17 communities that, you know, where they have this other model, right, where they haven't gone through the RFP process, I'm really wondering how you've looked into how that process has happened, what have been some of the best practices, and really some way to kind of break out some of those pros and cons, as well as kind of wondering what your general counsel's opinion has sort of been as far as whether or not this RFP process is in fact required. It sounds like there's been some question back and forth from folks, and just really being able to have that, I think, would be really helpful. And really, ultimately, you know, as finance, you know, my husband will tell you I'm always keeping an eye on the household budget. But money is really important, but money isn't the vision, right? Money supports the vision, it buys the vision, it builds the vision. And I just hope, as our financial manager, that you kind of can see that our taxes and the money that comes into this town is part of trying to build that vision of what Amherst is to be, because it's really easy just to get lost in the bottom line and what kind of looks good in a balance sheet. But there's a context here, and, you know, we're Amherst, only the H is silent. You can't take away our voice for that, but thank you.
Just as a quick reminder while she makes her way up, in general, when we take public comment, we'll, you know, so if question, if you have questions, that sort of thing, we'll take them. We don't generally respond in a back and forth in general. There might be a clarifying question we ask just to make sure we're understanding, but that's about it. So we're generally not going to do a dialogue back and forth. So I don't want to, I want to sort of set expectations for people as they provide us with their comments. So.
Hello, I'm Brenda Bushhouse. I joined the Amherst Media Board in August as the higher education representative. But what I do at UMass is I teach nonprofit management. And I wanted to speak to it from that perspective, and also someone that's taught urban politics for many years. So a 501c3, like Amherst Media, needs to have independence to fulfill its mission. Once the town takes the RFP approach, which it's not required to do, it will have control over that mission. Right now, the board is made up of those that are appointed. We have very slots that are appointed, like me from higher ed, Rick Hood from the school of, school committee, and then we have others. We have a pretty broad perspective of the community. And I think the board has to be operating in a policy position to fulfill the mission, to make strategic decisions for the organization. Now, the RFP that could be put forward with, for Amherst Media through the town will be what the town wants. What happens then to a 501c3's independent board? I would really, really encourage you to consider that. And I think I'm very familiar with public management and the need for a partnership, but when you have an organization like Amherst Media, who most of its budget is coming through this contract with Comcast, it's not like a housing or a RFP like ServiceNet that has up to, like, who knows how many RFPs they go after to get the contracts. This is a 501c that is financially dependent on this contract. And so I'm very, very alarmed at the distortion that could happen to Amherst Media's board in its role in an independent 501c3 nonprofit. Thank you.
Anyone else on this side? If not, then we'll switch to this side. Let's start here with the in the front, second row there. Thank you.
My name is Stanley Marin, and I moved to Amherst 11 years ago, and just a couple of months ago, we moved to Lathrop Retirement in Northampton. But anyway, I have done some work with Amherst Media, interacted on a minor level, and I found them to be very cooperative and understanding. And one thing is on my mind, wherever I go, there's a problem of austerity on the world level, on a global level. Countries have been asked to become, spend less, more austerity in the community, all the way from global down to here. They want to cut. And what are they cutting from? The lady who owns Broadside Bookstore in Northampton told me that George Orwell's book, 1984, sold out. People are, a lot of people are beginning to question what kind of a society we live in. As a matter of fact, right now, I feel as if I'm talking to the People's Board of Understanding. And you understand me, but the Comcast people and the 1% and the people who run the society, with the greater inequality that's taken place, don't understand. So I talk, just to end as a viewer, when I turn on Channel 12 in the morning, I enjoy Amy Goodman. That's the best journalist I know that tells you things that are happening that you don't find anywhere. After that, I hear discussions. Very often, it's people who are my age. Now, you don't see a talking head on any of the channels that's anywhere. They're one-third of my age. So I begin to feel as if I belong somewhere. And I hear labor programs, rap shows, serious shows, all kinds of things on Amherst Media that I don't hear elsewhere. And I think that we should make it a priority not to, as the woman said, not to fix it. It's pretty good now. It's real good now. Thank you.
Thank you. So let's go here next.
Thanks. I'm Jeff. Jeff Lee. I was on the board of ACTV shortly after the current or the previous contract was started. I'd like to express my appreciation for what Amherst Media has provided over the past 10 years. In my view, the direct payment model with appropriate oversight and the services being provided by an independent nonprofit have worked quite well. I think among the biggest achievements of Amherst Media over the past 10 years are totally renovating the studio space and bringing new equipment in, starting new training programs, getting a cross-section of the community involved in production. And I'm just grateful for that. I think I'd worry about the problems transitioning to a new model and perhaps a new entity providing the services. I seriously doubt that they could do a better job. I think, by and large, Amherst Media does a great job. And I'm not sure if the vision is bringing the PEG services into town government, but if that is, I think it would be a mistake. I think independence is important for ensuring creativity and balance. So thank you.
Thank you. So we'll go, I'm working front to back, so we'll go here next. Sorry.
My name is Anna Carter. I was on the executive committee with Isaac Ben Ezra and served for 3 years. And one thing I learned was that democracy is very messy and not always fun, but it includes everybody. Everyone has a voice, and that's one reason I decided to serve on ACTV. And now it's called Amherst Media, but it was called ACTV then. One question I have from listening to all this discussion is, I hear that the select board feels that they're compelled to do an RFP because it's ordained by the state law, but I'm hearing that other people have researched and feel that it's not mandatory. So my question to the select board is, if you have other reasons for feeling that you have to do an RFP besides that it's compelled by law, can you please be transparent with the community of why you feel it's important to go out for an RFP? Because I pretty much agree, if it may not be perfect, but if it ain't broke, why fix it? So I'm hoping that you can be transparent with the community, as you are also servants to the community, just as I was when I served on ACTV, and as anyone in a controlling board is a service to the community. And the other thing that I just want to, it's very obvious, but it's the citizens of Amherst who pay Comcast. It's the citizens' money that is providing the funds that, in turn, the least we can do is control our cable access station. So thank you very much.
Thank you. So So Vince, if you would please. Mr. O'Connor, I should say.
So in this situation, Vince O'Connor, Summer Street, Precinct 1, town meeting member. So in this situation, I think I sort of have a nuts and bolts approach. The first thing I think that the board needs to say is if there's been no decision for the RFP process and you have four members, before anything happens, I think the board needs to make a decision whether to go forward. Not everything a town manager recommends gets approved by the select board. Been here 40 years, I've watched it happen a lot. Sometimes the manager strikes out. And I guess it concerns me that we've gone this far since the contract with Comcast was signed. And, you know, maybe I'm wrong, but I understand that the people who work at Amherst Media have not gotten paid, which I think is not a good thing. This should not have gone this far without that happening. The second thing is that at the point where there is a genuine public dispute about whether there is a may or shall in a thing that somebody says is a requirement, other says is an option, I think the select board goes from relying on the manager to provide information to becoming responsible for knowing the information directly themselves and making the judgment themselves. What Amherst Media does for this community with our money from Comcast seems to be really an important thing to this community. And so the board, I think, needs to do those two things. There's clearly a dispute. The board needs to, each individual member of this board needs to personally know whether, in fact, it is a requirement. And I think it would be a tragedy to destroy this organization for the reasons that appear not to be really meaningful. I haven't heard anything. This process doesn't seem to be being moved by anything by what one person says is a requirement and other people say is not. And I just, you've got to resolve this. This is not something you can rely on somebody else for. This is too important an organization in this community to say, well, they say this, and the manager says that, we'll just rely on what the manager says. Okay? You can't do that anymore.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Adrienne Terizzi, and I am your current representative to the Amherst Media Board. I would like to be gracious in my appreciation for you taking the amount of time you have tonight. I also served, as you well know, on the Comcast negotiation team. I was one of five members that happily delivered, with the help of Amherst Media and its staff, the $1.125 million that we were planning to use for addressing our government channels, our public channels, and our educational channels. I still look forward to that. And I do want to say that following the completion of our negotiations, we were very hopeful before the select board stepped in to complete those negotiations that we would have an opportunity to have a public hearing. I think that's very much what we're getting tonight. And I do thank you for listening to everyone who has come forward to speak. I'm not going to go back over all the reasons you heard tonight, but but I would like to leave you with one thought. I've taken my responsibilities in representing the town and being the liaison to the town and trying to balance that with what I need to bring to the Amherst Media Board as a fully functioning, equitable partner. I have to say that I am unconvinced that the route that you believe must be sought by the new DOR requirements is in the best interest of either. So I would appreciate your thoughtful deliberation tonight. I would like to stay around and hear all of it, and thank you again.
Thank you. So I'm not seeing any other hands at the moment. Sure. This, by the way, will be our last speaker.
Hi, I'm MJ Donahue. I live in Amherst. I just want to speak to the education I got when I went to high school in Amherst and was an intern at Amherst Community Television. The director at the time was nice enough to sit down with me and give me one-on-one instruction on how to be a video editor. And I was able to leave school early and get school credit for that internship. And after going to college and taking video classes there and also using Amherst High School's video class, I have to say that was the only place available for me to get that type of one-on-one instruction. And as somebody who did not continue with my college, that type of instruction and the knowledge I got from it was invaluable to me getting further positions working in community media centers. I've also been a member of Cambridge Community Television in 2015, and I'm currently a member of Amherst Media and would like to, you know, be a part of them continuing on with the mission that they have been for so many years holding up for the community. And I also want to say this is an opportunity for us to think about what kind of community this is and who we are serving. I see the Select Board has a lot of Apple products. Not everybody has that ability to get access to a laptop or their own technology to create media, and Amherst Media is one place they can go and for a very affordable fee be able to create their own media, have their own voice, and not have any government getting in the way of that relationship. And also, you know, are any nonprofits going to want to be in this town if there is this type of hostility towards their functioning on a regular basis? So that has been my experience with Amherst Media, always very supportive and giving me another way when some of the traditional methods, even though I know this is a college town, but not everybody's involved with the colleges or has access to those resources. Amherst Media provides that for people. So I just want to point that out. Thank you.
Thank you. And I would like to say that we appreciate the comments of the community in regard to this issue, and we take, you know, your comments seriously and under advisement to us. I think at this point, does the Select Board have other comment? So,
well, just a couple people had asked, you know, are we going to deliberate tonight? On our agenda, it actually says update, which, I didn't realize we were going to do something similar to a hearing. We have a lot of other things. Maybe I'm not ready to decide tonight because I would like, as we always do, to go back and reconsider the information. I know as members, we have also done our own research and reading about the requirements. Some of it might be a judgment call, and some of it might be more on the line of requirement. I think it warrants further exploration, as people had mentioned. So I wouldn't want us to make a decision tonight, but we might just go around so people know where we're at for the sake of transparency, kind of how we're approaching it very quickly, so that we can, while everybody's here on this issue, you know, say a few words about what we're thinking and what our process is going to be. But I am not ready to vote a decision about our process right now.
Sure. Thank you for that. And I do think that's a good idea to sort of have each of us kind of give a sense of where we're at with regard to this issue. And so I'll look to either Mr. Steinberg or Mr. Wald, who would like to go first?
So I've been talking tonight. I mean, first of all, I think this is a good example of a good process. And, you know, Amherst is a town that's known for its civic engagement, so I'm very glad that people came out to talk to us. And I'm sorry if it seemed confrontational at times. I think we were responding in some sense to the fact that we were, in a sense, being accused of doing something improper, whether by design or by omission. And I want to assure everyone that's not the case, that we wouldn't be considering the RFP issue, as I understand it, unless we've been advised by professional staff with expertise in the field and after considerable research that we had to take this course. So, and as I understand it too, the RFP RFP does not entail a given outcome. Anyone can apply who's qualified for that. So, although I understand the concerns of the public, I think the public, I would ask them to understand the process that we're going through and the due diligence, the transparency, the fiduciary responsibility, and as Ms. Kruger said, the possibility just to state for the public what it is we're looking for here. So I guess there are two questions. There's the abstract question of whether one would issuing an RFP is the best way to go forward in finding a provider for this, especially given the long-time service, excellent service by a beloved community organization. And there's the legal absolute requirement there. And I guess I'm a little taken aback by the suggestion of government by Google that we're all supposed to go look up things on our own. I mean, I'm accustomed not to giving a rubber stamp, but to respecting the expertise of the town manager, who is a trained professional and who has corresponded with people in the field, including our town council, whom we retain at the taxpayer's dollar to give us accurate advice about this. So all things being equal, I take that as having a fair amount of weight. Given that we have time, I think it is fine, as Ms. Kruger said, to do further investigation and be absolutely sure about the shalls, maize, cans, and so forth. And looking at the calendar, I see that we're asking to advertise an RFP by February 28th, so basically 3 weeks from now. And I wonder whether the process, we could follow a two-track process. That is, we could prepare an RFP as we deem fit and continue to consider the legal questions as we go forward.
Yeah, I guess I want to do several things. One, first of all, I want to thank several groups of people who are in the room who have really committed themselves to this community and to the importance of the service that's provided for public programming, educational programming, government programming. And that's, of course, people who've served on the board of directors, people who've served as volunteers for Amherst Media and either currently or in the past, and people who served on the Cable Advisory Committee, who did a tremendous job of helping us to get to the point where we are now, which is taking a very good contract that would not have been achieved but for the hard work of the CAC working in partnership with the Select Board. So I want to recognize all of that. And we are all about the same thing. We're talking about how we benefit the community. I do want to close with a couple of observations that I made at the beginning. One is that this is a new regulation. It was issued, and it does just offer two options. And it's not two options in some vague other that you can create. It states what it states. Point that has been raised, and I have thought about significantly previously, is that there are other communities that do what we have done in the past of a direct pass-through, but what's missing is, were those arrangements made subsequent to the enactment of a regulation that isn't even enforceable until July 1 of 17? So it's sort of this unknown piece of information is on those communities. If we didn't have the unhappy coincidence, as it is, that our contract renewal with Comcast was up when it was at, we would probably be in the same position as those other communities in trying to figure out what to do in mid-contract when there has been this new requirement, but we do have to deal with the fact as it is. We have a new requirement that has been put in place, and we are about to issue a contract, and we have not just tripped upon this on our own, but have consulted with staff at Department of Revenue and at our certified public accountant. And the last comment that I want to make is that I was a director of a nonprofit organization for better than 25 years, and we provided legal assistance to low-income people, and almost all of our funds was by grants and contracts that came through a process that had some type of RFP to it. And, you know, that is just the nature of how nonprofits function. And well-designed RFPs, which is what we were always advocating for, and I certainly understand Amherst Media's board and staff arguing for, too, for the same reason, are looking for an RFP that reasonably serves the public interest for the service that is the mission of the organization. But it is a common process, and I think that that's something that is therefore one that seems to, just from my own personal experience, to be a logical way to proceed, in addition to the fact that now that I'm on this side of it with the select board, the law requires it. The town cannot issue a contract without going through the requirements of a procurement process, which is different from where we were in the last round. So, thank you.
Thank you. I think I'll conclude this section. I'll just say that I appreciate everyone coming out tonight and sharing their thoughts with us. I can't speak for my colleagues, but I'm sure that they, like me, will take your thoughts and concerns under due consideration as we move ahead with this. And again, we appreciate you coming out tonight and letting us know your opinions and thoughts on the matter. Thank you. And I think we'll take a short recess so that we can...
I'll pass.
What's that?
I'll pass. You didn't... I wasn't included in the go-round,
oh,
but I have said a
I'm
lot
sorry.
Already.
I didn't know if... All right, I'm sorry. I thought that initiating you would have sort of said what you needed to say. Would you like to add some more? I'm certainly happy to...
I actually think I have said a lot tonight. Let's clarify. It's certainly a healthy thing when people correspond with us. I was... you know, people don't know what some people wrote, and you know, sometimes I know we're public officials, so I have to take the heat. But most people were quite respectful, and to the point. But I was reacting to a couple of them. I just wanted to say about the RFP process that whether it's a requirement or not, I haven't decided yet for myself which is preferable for the town. But I just want to say from my own experience, it's a competitive process. So it's a little hard to sit here and say, well, you know, you guys have it hands down because you can't do that, because we're designing a competitive process by law. But people write letters of support for proposals. And if the kind of a response we've gotten is any show of support, I would say it certainly would be invaluable in responding to a request for a proposal as well.
Thank you. Thank you.
Has been.
What's that? I'm sorry.
Mr. Bach.
I presume that.
Onto your individual mailbox.
I take it under advisement.
We'll certainly take it under advisement. I'm not sure. We'll check with the chair as far as just general process and procedure. Generally, we do put out in general to be made available publicly. And so, barring it being onerous to folks to do, I think we probably would likely do that. But it's a fair volume. I mean, I don't want to diminish that at all.
But
we'll take it under advisement in that
Thank
regard.
You, because I think the electronic media can handle
Sure. So we'll take a short recess so we can find our chair and bring her back to
to chair the rest of the meeting.
Okay, so it is now 8:15 p.m. We had a brief recess. I want to thank Mr. Slaughter for taking all of that on. I appreciate that. And we are now going to move into our next action and discussion item. However, we are going to have a slight change in the order in that we are going to move to item C, which is the senior tax work-off abatement request to increase from $1,000 to $1,500 under Mass General Law Chapter 59, Section 5 and K. And if you would just give us the intro,
sure.
Mr. Bachman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So currently we have a tax work-off program for seniors of up to $1,000. And the state law has changed that allows a community to increase that amount from $1,000 to $1,500. We have our Director of Senior Services, Nancy Pagano, here. We have Mara Plant, our Program Director, and we have our Principal Assessor, who happens to be here as well, who could also address any questions you may have. Right now, we limit it to 35 people, and if you were to increase it, it would have a potential increase of $13,000 annually. And Ms. Plant is really the one who's been pushing this or promoting it. I won't say pushing it. My mistake. But her interest on behalf of seniors is pretty strong, as is the whole senior team there. So.
Great. Are there any questions? So why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself for the folks at home and bend the mic really close down to your face. Thank you.
My name is Maura Plant. I'm the Program Director for Services at the Senior Center.
Excellent. And we have a memo here from you, which is in our packet for those of you following along at home, along with a copy of Mass General Law. We have a motion in front of us tonight on our motion sheet to increase the maximum gross abatement to a certain amount per year. Now, this is something that does not need to be approved by town meeting. This is something we do here.
That's correct.
Okay. Only. All right. Questions from the select board for Ms. Plott? Otherwise, I'm going to ask somebody to read a motion. So the memo is dated February 3rd. Oh, you've got the motion? All right.
I'd like to read the motion and then have a very short
discussion.
Comment.
Sure.
Discussion afterwards. So I move to amend the program rules for senior citizen property tax abatements under Mass General Law, Chapter 59, Section 5K, as amended November 7th, 2016. By increasing the maximum gross abatement for the tax work-off program from $1,000 a year to $1,500 a year.
Second. And you said you had a comment.
Well, just a couple things. A number of years ago served on the Board of Assessors, and I was very proud that Amherst had, by local option, pretty much maximized the amount of tax benefits we could offer people with in different need categories. And I think the senior the work-off program is really important. And when you look at the dollars for our properties, you know, going from 1,000 to 1,500 is a meaningful help for people who may have houses valued or assessed at quite a bit because they've been there quite a long time, but their income has pretty much stagnated because it's fixed on, you know, whether it's Social Security or other forms. So their opportunity to increase that income really diminishes as they get older. But our tax assessment is based on value. So I think this is a modest way to help people stay in town and afford their home. So I was very pleased to see this before us, and I think it's a modest and important step. So.
Great, Mr. Steinberg.
Yeah, several questions I do need to ask. One is, right now it's your memo indicated we have 35 slots and only 26 participants in the program. I was wondering if you had conception of why we have the vacancies and whether you think the increase will fill those vacancies. So that's question one, and then I have a couple follow-ups, but I'll stop.
Last year there were 34 participants in the program. This year there are some people who had been in the program for, you know, 6, 7, 8 years, and they have decided that they wanted to do something different in addition to they were not financially eligible due to, income. They were above the income guidelines. And then there was a person who moved from her home to an assisted living facility. And then there was, unfortunately, a person who passed away. So I am hoping that if the increase is passed, that that will also make it more appealing to other folks.
Okay, thank you. It's also a question of what is fair compensation for and fair stipend to pay, which then gets to the second question to ask either the town manager or the assessor. Is this money that's ultimately comes from the overlay account?
Yes, it is. It comes from the overlay account.
So then the third question I have in the sequence is, given the fact that we're also going into a year of assessments, we have known in the past is a year that puts strain on the overlay accounts, is there any concern that there may not be adequate funding in the overlay account?
The principal assessor's eager to answer this question.
What's eager?
Willing.
I don't believe there will be any excess burden on the overlay accounts. We will go into revaluation year, but we have been very good recently of keeping the overlay at a relatively good level. And there's also been a change in the way we use the overlay. When the Modernization Act came in earlier this year, the overlay allows us now to use money from previous years that's left on the overlay, and we have a good balance, so we can carry that forward. So there'll always be money there. There's money there that we can use if there is any need for it. Amherst is a very strong overlay. We have about 1% of the levy that we use, and we very, very seldom in 25 years have we gone over it. So I'm very confident we're fine.
Okay. Thank you.
Excellent. Other questions? I know in the past, some years ago, there had been concern as to whether there were enough hours per person, should there be more slots and fewer hours, et cetera, but it looks like, given that there are some vacancies right now, that that's not a pressure you're currently facing.
Correct.
Simplifies. Great. Other questions? Are we ready to come to a vote? All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And that passes unanimously. Thank you for coming
in,
and thank you for your patience and waiting for us to get to that agenda item. And thank you for championing the cause. Not pushing it, but championing. So now we will move to item B, which is the 2017 CDBG, also known as Community Development Block Grant, recommendations, where we review the town manager's recommendation. This is the town manager's decision based on input from the Community Development Block Grant Advisory Committee, and we have a memo from them in our packet as well. So I'll turn it to Mr. Bachelman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So the CDBG Advisory Committee, as is usual, has reviewed all the applications for the 2017 CDBG funds. They reviewed 7 very strong social service proposals and 3 non-social service proposals. The grant does not have to include funding for social services, but this is a requirement of other this is not a requirement of other communities, but the town has historically done this, and the committee has been recommending to me 5 proposals at 20% of the grant application, which is the maximum you're allowed. In short, you have a list of the 8 recipients of the proposed funding, and if you have any comments, Mr. Malloy, our senior planner, is here to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you. Questions from the select board. We are fortunate enough, when we can do this every year because we qualify for block grant money. Questions? Otherwise, I'm going to entertain a motion from somebody. It is, actually, there is no motion because this is up to you.
That's right.
Right, this is up to you. So this is a question of whether or not, right, we say, wow, have you thought of this? Or look, that looks great. And some years we have those conversations and other years we don't. Yes.
Just a sort of a question, comment. I know that the advisory committee works really diligently on this, as does the staff support, Mr. Malloy in particular. So I don't really question what's been brought forward, but when I was looking at the social service recommendations, I did wonder, some of these we have funded, if not the program, the organization for many years, and it might be useful at some point to look at how many years a particular recipient has been funded and whether there was, you know, kind of opportunities there were for sort of new programs to come in and how the committee looks at that. So I was just curious. I'm sure that has come up in the conversation.
Sure, yeah. For this year, that was a topic of discussion in the fall of 16, and the committee discussed whether or not they would, you know, have a system where, you know, organizations that were funded in consecutive years would get reduced funding, or, you know, if maybe they would try to encourage new applicants. But they decided that each year, or at least for this year, they would look at it just, you know, for this current year, and the fact that they wouldn't give any extra weight to someone who's been funded before or who hasn't been funded. So they just rated the you know, the proposals based on the criteria at hand, irrelevant if they've received funding in the past. I think moving forward, it's something they will consider probably every year. You know, do they have some criteria where they can rank the points? So maybe they try to, you know, I don't want to say penalize, but, you know, they give weight to other communities or other proposals that don't have, you know, consistent funding year after year. It's a difficult thing because as a mini entitlement community, DHCD has already determined that Amherst has the need and we have the population and the services that can accommodate it. So the committee was trying to determine, you know, what is the best route there if DHCD already, you know, has determined we have the need in the population and we have all these services that are, you know, as long as they're eligible, they could get funding. How do you start determining, you know, which one is, you know, does a need go away, for instance? So if we funded an organization 10 years in a row, has the need gone away if they can document the need? And so the committee determined this year not to use that criteria. But again, that's something that they did consider.
Thank you. And that's one of the things that comes up at their public meetings. Also, reflecting to just fairly recently, in terms of our homeless shelter, a large portion of the social service money was going there for a number of years. And so there had been agencies that had previously received block grant money, entitlement money, then didn't because we were spending most of it on the shelter. Then as we transitioned from paying for the vast majority of the shelter's operations, then they were able to come in. So it's always this ebb and flow. Mr. Steinberg.
Yeah, I guess the one question that I would have, Mr. Malloy, is that I noticed that the amount recommended for the East Hadley Road pedestrian improvements multi-use path was significantly reduced from the funding request. And if you could just let us have some idea of what was diminished in what's going to be offered as a result of that reduction in funding.
Sure. Yeah. The actual, you know, project to create a multi-use path, you know, the proposal, the budget was much higher than this. So we had determined it could be done in phases. And so the amount allocated, about $350,000, would, you know, it would just diminish the length of the proposal. We'd still want to get from Route 116 to the first entrance of the apartment complexes and the first bus stop. But the original idea was to try to get further along on the road and maybe have some other improvements, you know, site amenities or things. But with this budget, it would be at least to get a continuous path on the ground, you know. And if that meant that maybe we wouldn't have benches in place, but we'd still provide concrete pads for bus shelters, you know, there would be some give and take there with the budget. So that was really it. I mean, the idea we were hoping was to get a sidewalk along the whole length of East Hadley Road, and the amount here will mean that it has to be shortened, but we're seeing it as, you know, a phase one now of a maybe a phase two, you know, two-phase project.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. That's always a helpful question. It also applies when social service agencies have a substantially different amount, because sometimes they simply can't run the program anymore if we cut it by, depending on what fractions it gets cut by. So some years when we get this report, we have a cover letter from the town manager that says, this is why I disagree with the Block Grant Advisory Committee's recommendations. We don't have that memo this year, so I guess that means you don't.
That's correct.
It would have made for a very short
memo. I trust
memo.
The process.
Excellent. All right, other questions? Next stage in the process. If you'll just, since you have the moment to give the commercial, Mr. Malloy, as to what happens next.
Yes, applications are due March 10th. We have a public hearing this Thursday. The Block Grant Committee will hold a public hearing to receive comments on the recommendations for funding. This is a DHCD requirement. And then, you know, that leaves the town enough time to put together an application. I feel good about that. Sometimes we give ourselves, you know, less time than we have now. So we're in a good position this year.
Fortunately. Great. Well, the state gave you until March instead of February, which is kind of nice. A nice change. All right. So do we have any further comments from the select board? And I don't believe there are any from the audience. So we are going to say thank you and make it so. And thank you, Mr. Malloy. And please pass our thanks along to the Community Development Block Grant Advisory Committee. I know it's difficult for them to have to say no to people. So thank you. And let's see. We are now at 8:31, going to move to item D. For those of you following along at home, we have lots more to do after that. But we are going to now move to the Affordable Housing Property Tax Incentive based on annual town meeting action of May 11th, 2015, Article 21. North Square at the Mill District, also known as Beacon, and I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Bockelman. And I'm sorry, I'm going to be slightly distracting, and then I'm going to take some handouts to the back of the room. You don't mind? They're separate. They're separate, clipped together, so they're just separate piles.
Oh, okay.
And they're separate piles. Yes, people can collate themselves. And the select board should have that on their desk tonight.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So, in the back of the room is my. Memo, and that will be uploaded tomorrow along with the consultant's report and additional materials. Beacon Communities Development LLC has requested an affordable housing tax incentive estimated to be $2,795,009 over the 10-year life of the incentive for North Square at the Mill District. This is the town's first opportunity to utilize this new tool, the affordable housing tax incentive, for the development of affordable housing in Amherst. After careful consideration and the assistance of staff and a third-party consultant, I'm recommending the select board approve this request. This the memo that you have in front of you summarizes the analysis of the request and further explains the recommendation. Tonight, we have the support of several experts who can help us in our decision-making. We have Peter Graham and Tillman Lucas from MBL Housing Development, Inc., and you have their credentials as part of your packet. We have Principal Assessor David Burgess and Senior Planner Nate Malloy. And just in reference, we also had Town Council review the memo and the proposed motion. So you're well familiar with this project. The North Square at the Mill District proposed by Beacon Communities would create a mixed-use, mixed-income development consisting of two new buildings containing 130 residential units, including 20% or 26 affordable units at 50% area median income, 22,000 square feet of non-residential space, and approximately 304 parking spaces, and including site improvements on an approximately 5.3-acre leased site on a 13-acre property in North Amherst. When I was writing this, the ZBA was still considering the project, but as my understanding, Mr. Malloy can confirm this, or Ms. Kruger, who were there, that they have voted the comprehensive permit and waivers and conditions before your meeting tonight at 6 p.m., I believe. Okay. So as I said, you're very familiar with this. The public participation in the process has been extensive. It began back in May of 2016 when the developers met with neighbors. I think their original plan showed 140 units when I read the newspaper articles. And there has been extensive public comment at the ZBA level and at your meetings. You've had at least six meetings where you've had this opportunity to talk about it. You've walked the site on a site visit prior to the DHCD letter that you wrote. ZBA has had seven public hearings on the program. So what is the affordable housing tax incentive? And it's a unique tool, and it's the first time we're able to utilize it. And at the annual town meeting in 2015, Article 21 was approved, which authorized the select board to file a special act with the general court. The special act authorized the select board to enter into agreements allowing for the phasing in of the increase in assessed property value resulting from developments of residential or mixed uses with 10 or more dwelling units and in which at least 10% of the units are below a low or moderate income housing and subject to an affordable housing restriction. So the idea behind the program was that this would be a way to provide financial support for a project without an appropriation from the town that would compete with other resources the town or the projects the town was trying to do. It was seen as being a tool and a set of tools to encourage the development of affordable housing. Developing affordable housing in this market and in this community is a big challenge. The amount is a very broad legislation that was passed. The amount and length of reduction would be determined based on the economics of each eligible development and negotiated on a case-by-case basis. The general court, which is the legislature, passed and the governor signed this act in December 4th, 2015. So how does it work? Basically what we do is we look at a base year of when the project, upon issuance of an occupancy permit by the building commissioner, and then increase that that benefit and the taxes by, we estimate, 2.5% a year. It's not guaranteed it will be 2.5%. It could be higher, it could be lower, and then that would be, and we can do that for 10 years. We continue to collect taxes during the construction period, and the CPA surcharge would continue to be paid, and the commercial elements of the project, of the development, would pay their full weight of taxes. They don't get any relief. The interesting thing about this is that because it's not an appropriation, it's foregone revenue. So it's not money we have already that we're taking out of our budget. It's just that we're getting less revenue than we otherwise would have had. And the other good thing about this is that if the project doesn't move forward, it doesn't receive funding from other the other elements of the financing package, or there's construction delays or anything like that, there's no investment by the town. The town only starts, we start to receive funding, revenue, but also the reductions don't start until the occupancy permit has been issued and the structure is up and running. This is not an abatement, which is a good thing from the principal assessor's point of view, and he finds that a valuable consideration. So since it was the first time that we were looking at this, I had a lot of questions and our staff had a lot of questions because we looked at all the information that was considered at the annual town meeting that was delivered to the State House and tried to grapple with how we would analyze this for your consideration. And the first thing we did is we thought we should get somebody who knew a little bit more about it than we did. And we contracted with MBL Housing and Development of Amherst, who have had extensive experience in reviewing projects like this and doing developments. They're very familiar with large developments. They're very familiar with affordable housing structures and with affordable housing financing packages. We asked them to do three things. First off, did this development qualify for the tax incentive? Did it meet the bar, the threshold, to become considered for this tool? Second, is the request by the developer within the bounds of the tax incentive? Were they asking for too much, more than the tax incentive could offer? And thirdly, and this is probably the most important thing from our point of view, was determine if the development budget, which is called a pro forma, was reasonable. Were the assumptions that they built into the development budget inflated in any way? Were they based on real life examples in our community in this part of the state? The MBL's full report has been, you have copies of that, and their statement of qualifications is attached as well. So I'm going to summarize this because you can read the report. But the answers were that the North Square at the Mill District Development does qualify for affordable housing tax incentives under the special act. Second, the calculation method recommended by the town's principal assessor and used by Beacon in their request produced the lowest tax incentive and highest taxes paid over the course of the 10-year life of the tax incentive. There are other assumptions that would be reasonably built, could be reasonably built into calculations that would have projected a larger tax incentive, but these seem to be the most rational ones. And third, all assumptions in the development's proposed budget were consistent with industry standards based on NBL's or consultants' knowledge and experience. There are many the memo goes into a number of questions like, is the development feasible? What are the possible benefits of the development? I mean, some of the benefits are it produces deep affordability, has subsidized, it increases the number of units in our subsidized housing inventory, which is very critical to our future as a community. I think an important item is that it's a mixed-use development, but it's a high-quality mixed-use development and sets a high standard for development going forward in this area where we anticipate there'll be more development. So the finishes on the building, the site amenities are require a large investment, and we want that as part of our community. We looked at whether this public subsidy was in line with other public subsidies for other affordable housing developments. And new construction for development of this can be in $350,000. We can look to our consultants for what that would look to be. This subsidy would turn out to be about $108,000 per unit, and that is higher than some developments that we've had in town, but lower than others. For instance, the town has contributed $160,000 per unit to the Hawthorne Farm Habitat for Humanity. The town has invested significant funds into affordable housing, and it has determined that this is an efficient way to build affordable housing using private developers versus the town or some other public entity building these units totally. We looked at the impact on the town's finances. As you all know, we are struggling with managing increasing expenses for our fixed costs like OPEB and health insurance and things like that, and retirement. And we also have a great demand to maintain our existing services and often many requests to increase services for public safety and other areas. Our tax base is constrained because we're a highly residential community and we rely 90% on residential taxes. New tax growth and new development is important to the lifeblood of our community as we look to maintain our services. Currently, this site pays about $10,000 a year in taxes. We looked at what would the site produce in taxes if it were built just with under existing zoning, and it was estimated that 61 residential units could be constructed. And if fully taxed, these 61 residential units would generate about $212,000 in taxes annually. And that would inflate, again, that 2.5% every year, give or, plus or minus, would inflate by year 11 to $265,000 a year. At maturity, when this project gets to year 11, we estimate that the residential portion will generate $486,000 in residential taxes, plus another $87,000 in commercial taxes for a total of $574,000 in taxes annually, nearly twice what a by right development would produce. So I'm not going to read the entire memo, and we have people here who are willing to comment on it if you have questions. So I want to give you a little background on how I came to recommend this project to you, this tax incentive. We looked at this tool as a tool that was available to the town to encourage affordable housing. It's a flexible tool. The board could use it to support a project without having a negative impact on the budget of the town. One of the other things we considered was the strength of the developer. The developer has a strong market presence and knows the market and knows the community, and we felt, and I felt, that that was an important consideration for you, something for you to consider. We felt that the developer would produce quality, affordable units. We believe that this is not high end, but very good construction, and by nature that increases development costs and sets up a high bar for the standard of construction in this area. And so I think it's a unique opportunity to work with a quality developer. So we have put a chart in here in your packet on the last page that shows the year-by-year taxes that would be paid. And I think the headers are on the wrong page, unfortunately, and I apologize for that. I didn't realize that until I just looked at it now. So the first column is the year 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Ours looks okay.
Yours looks okay?
Ours looks okay.
Oh, I printed out mine.
Okay.
I did mine. Okay,
so ours
sorry.
Starts on the bottom of page 6, and it should be easy to follow.
Yeah. So again, I think it's really important to note two things. First, the development would continue to pay its full taxes for its apportioned share of the CPA tax. And second, that the taxes on the commercial component are not included in the affordable housing tax incentive. And taxes for the commercial component would be assessed in addition to the residential tax assessment. And you have a motion there that's been reviewed by Town Council. And if you have any questions for any of us, or consultants, we stand ready to answer them for you.
Great. So a couple of more logistical type things. Ms. Kruger, you said you wanted to make a statement? Okay. All right. And then the other thing I wanted to say is, because a good bit of this material was only provided to the Select Board this afternoon in email, that doesn't mean all of us had time to actually read it this afternoon. And so that we, as you've indicated, we are very aware of what brought us to this point, because we've talked about it a lot of different times, but we hadn't seen some of the exact figures or comments until this afternoon. So does anyone on the Select Board need some time to look over the documentation more before we turn to questions and answers, brief presentations, whatever we want to do? I just want to give people the opportunity to have time to look at it if you felt like you didn't have any. I appreciate that people made the time to work in amongst their various other jobs to make this happen this afternoon. So hearing no request for some silent reading time, which always makes for fascinating viewing at home, we will go ahead and move on then. And so we have quite a number of people here, as you've indicated. And so how might you suggest we proceed?
Well, maybe Peter Graham, if you want to talk about your process for your how you did the analysis, that would be helpful, I think.
That'd be great. Thank you. And just make sure you have the mic really close to you.
Close enough. Okay. So I guess to start with, a lot of the general analysis on the pro forma and its fit and based on our industry knowledge of multifamily developments of this nature in the region and across the state and otherwise, was a pretty straightforward analysis of looking at what we're seeing in the industry for operating costs, for development costs. We had access to the preliminary plans and specifications that were made public through the comprehensive permit process, and had access to any other information we requested from Beacon Communities. And really we weren't in a position to second guess the state and the other regulatory bodies who are going to have eyes on this project and review the cost assumptions and the sources and uses. This is a highly regulated industry where many people are vetting these assumptions, so in that sense it made it easy for us to compare with our knowledge and our you know, we have a pretty broad access to a lot of deals in a lot of through many years to see how that all, you know, shook out for these assumptions, and it made for pretty quick work to see that there wasn't anything outside the pale. In terms of a review on the tax calculation, we started with, of course, the methodology provided by the principal assessor, made sure we had a good grasp on understanding where that was coming from, what the triggers were for making that calculation work. And then we decided to take a look at a few different options for how could this logically be thought of differently, or were there any assumptions that we should review in terms specifically around the separating out the quote bonus units that the comprehensive permit provided. And in that sense, after a lot of looking at different possible analyses, we settled on one that basically carved out the 69 bonus units, taxed and took the tax on that, again using the same methodology that the principal assessor provided, and added that to a comparison between the 61 full market and 61 mixed deal, so that you could kind of get a little more of a apples to apples, if you will, comparison between 61 all market and 61 of the mixed, and then add the 69 market bonus units on top of that. And that calculation really came up incredibly close to where the town's calculation was at, but it was still required a more generous incentive. We also looked at the expense ratio used in the analyses, and that really was the biggest trigger for making for different tax incentives. So much of the language of the act and the what is going to create the size of the tax incentive is based on the NOI differences, and the assumption you use going into those expense ratios is going to make the biggest change on how that plays out. So we wanted to look at a more realistic expense ratio or expense per unit calculation, because we felt that the 50% expense ratio for the affordable units was well under what a reasonable project like this would see in real life. And so as we were looking at that, whether you use 9,000, 8,000, or 7,000 a unit per year for expenses, you would have a different size incentive. While the incentive would actually stay somewhat the same, what it would net out to the town changed, because with the cost ratios different, you'd have a different valuation, so you'd get more taxes paid, but you'd have a higher incentive. But as it nets out, you can see in the calculations that there's a direct relationship between the two. So when looking at the town's prescribed method, it really worked out in the favor of town by using the 50% ratio to limit the size of the tax incentive.
Thank you. If you would identify yourself again for the folks at home, that'd be helpful.
Sure. It's Peter Graham with MBL Housing and Development.
Did anyone have any questions for Mr. Graham at this point in the process? We can always ask him to come back up front, but while he's there, yeah, you guys are pointing at each other. Pick.
I have one that because I keep asking it every time we come up with this meeting. I guess I'm still a little bit confused by some aspects of how the pro forma is calculated because and how it's determined that it's reasonable, just knowing that state regulators are looking at it is comforting, but it doesn't really answer all of the questions that one might have about whether all of the costs that are estimated are reasonable costs. And I've picked on one because it's sort of easy more than anything else, not that I'm trying to single it out, and that's the ground rent question. Obviously the property does not carry a high value now in its current form because I think we have $10,000 a year in taxation from it. So that says something right there. But where it's going to and what is the and how that bears against the ground rent and how that is determined to be a reasonable and fair amount because it's a matter that was ultimately achieved by negotiations between a landowner who had an interest and a developer who had an interest. So if you could say anything, it would be helpful.
Sure. Well, we also, the commercial condominium or the commercial portion of the development is part of that acquisition negotiation. So turning over the commercial units to the landowner or the party that they've entered the ground lease with is part of the acquisition or can be viewed as part of the acquisition amount. So the appraisal that we were provided with, which is done by the state in the process of this of the 40B and the application for the amount of subsidies that are being drawn from the state for this deal are very close to the cost of the construction of that commercial combined with that that ground lease. And you could, and that wasn't necessarily part of our purview to review the variety of assumptions for the present cost of that future value of all that commercial. But when you look at just the soft costs and hard cost for building it and then turning it over combined with the ground lease that is in the pro forma, it's right there with the appraised value as which was an independent appraisal. So that pretty much is where we left that.
So the appraisal is looking at the estimated finished value as a whole?
Yeah, it would be an as complete appraisal, yes. Or actually, I'd have to. I don't believe it was an as complete appraisal, but I'd have to check. Okay. And can get back with you on that.
I was just curious. Thank you.
Definitely wasn't an as complete appraisal.
Would you like them to?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think it was a representative from Beacon who could give a little more information on.
Right. If you want to just shift over and let them pull up a chair. No. Microphone will probably not pick you up properly. They'll just, the people at home will just see your mouth moving.
No. Good evening, everyone. Darcy Jamison with Beacon Communities. So as part of the site eligibility process, the Department of Housing and Community Development does what's called an as-is appraisal. So they look at the land value in its existing condition before any kind of a comprehensive permit is issued. And so that's what was provided to MBL as the independent appraisal done by DHCD, looking at the as-is value. So looking at the value of the land as-is as compared to, as Peter was saying, the payment to for it.
So. Thank you.
Do you have more questions? Because I have a few things, but I wanted you to have yours. This is your area.
I'm still left a little bit uncertain because the as-is is where it is now, and how you determine a reasonable valuation after development is kind of a different piece. And so I just, you know, because it's something that doesn't exist, but it's a hypothetical evaluation, you know, it's an assessment of where it's going. And so that's why I was raising that question. But
yeah, I don't know that I could really add anything to that, in the sense that I mean, that's the point of the appraisal, was for the as is. It's it's similar to kind of, I think, any real estate transaction. It's what somebody might do with it is, you know, the value is going to be quite different, but that's not what they're purchasing now.
Sure. Just introduce yourself for the folks at home, too.
My name's Tillman Lucas. I'm also with MBL Housing and Development. as part of the process, what we also did was we looked at the income stream for the property less the expenses, and we determined what the actual NOI is, which is the net operating income. And there's a formula that's used in determining value for real estate, and we worked very closely with the principal assessor in making that determination. You look at the value of that net operating income, and you do what's called a capitalization rate. And that capitalization rate, which in this case was at 10.25%, and with that, you establish what the assessed value will be in the future. So that's how we came up with the assessed value. And then we compared the values between the different options that Peter described, which is the project all by itself as 130 units. And then we compared it with what the comprehensive permit allows, which is 69 bonus units versus 61 affordable mixed units, both 26 affordable units and 35 market rate units. And we did the same evaluation for each one of those scenarios by looking at what each individual component would be worth on an assessed value, using that same formula of the net operating income. Now, clearly what happens, and which is allowed under your article, is that the difference between the losses of income that those affordable units create, and that's quite substantial. Those units do not generate the sufficient income to be able to basically pay for their expenses, pay for additional taxes. And I think we came up with that formula, and I'm just going off the top of my head, but I believe the actual value on a taxable basis for those affordable units was about $5,000. So basically, no tax revenues could be generated from that. But as the comparison, we compared all of those, and then we took the taxes and we subtracted, we took the value of the tax, added it to the losses to reduce the amount of losses, and came up with what we considered to be the tax incentive. And this, once again, is a formula that was described in the article, and we used that same proration.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Krueger.
First of all, well, thank you for that. And I wanted to make a small disclosure. I don't know if I am required, but I've known Mr. Lucas for many years. And last year, as a consultant, I did work on a project for the town of Pelham. And he's, was the chair, I don't know if you still are, of the Affordable or the Housing Committee for Pelham. So I do have that relationship, but I'm no longer engaged in that, and I wanted to just disclose that I had that prior relationship with Mr. Lucas, but not with MBL. And my question is, I've been attending the Zoning Board of Appeals hearings, all seven of them. It was really informative. And along the way, and also some of the comments we received as emails and letters from a number of citizens, some residents said, yeah, use the tax incentive program, but use it to reduce the size of the project. Use it as your sort of fulcrum for making a smaller project because that's what we, in their opinion, was better. And, you know, another, so I'm wondering, or I'd like you to kind of answer for us and for the public who might be listening, why the size, the density of 130 units is needed. I know it wasn't really your job to look at kind of, you know, what if it was 120, 110, but I kind of approached this request from Beacon Communities as a necessary financial component to make this work, but not everybody agrees or views it that way, and having you assist us is really invaluable for us to be able to say, you know, the whole project bears the cost of being an affordable development, and what does that mean for the resultant size? So either or both of you, to, if you could help us with that question.
Peter Graham, again. I think this is where this, as Mr. Balkman mentioned, the different tools that are available, the comprehensive permit being one. When we look at comprehensive permits used by and large, where they're using significant density to achieve the income needed to cross-subsidize the affordables, we're talking much higher level of density than we see in this project. And
could you give some examples what that would be?
Well, we're I mean, they're around, you know, in the several hundreds of units, and in mostly the aggressive 40B projects in the greater Boston area, you know, would be the closest. I don't have any, you know, we can, you know, provide something.
And just, could you just explain what you mean when you say cross-subsidy?
Sure. Well, in the idea that you have enough units to, and income usually in much higher rent higher rent communities where 250 market rate units may support the 10% of affordable housing that's going into the development, so that and again in many cases with the where the 40B may be at 80% area median income for the units that are created, the delta to kind of make up the loss that the developer would have in their income is much smaller than with a project as proposed here, where you're going to a much deeper level of affordability with far fewer units to kind of cover that loss, as well as the fact that you don't really have 200 units covering the cost of 20 units. You have the 104 units. And I think the other piece as far as to speak of a little bit is the significant leveraging that this project is proposed to bring of state and federal resources through the low-income housing tax credit. These are, you know, there's tremendous, as is described in Beacon's letter, you know, several million, you know, $1 million, almost half the development cost is being supported by leveraging state available subsidies. So this, it isn't really in a situation of using the tax to make the program or to make the project smaller. It's really, you know, covering, as was articulated in the proposal, the operating pro forma needs to have a certain amount of private debt to make this doable, and this level of tax incentive is going to allow them to leverage to that level of debt. There's no real, you know, cushion here.
Thank you, that's helpful. Other questions from the select board? Why don't you tell us a little bit about our motion, because we have a longer motion on the end of your memo than we had on our motion sheet, because, you know, that was Thursday, and this is now Monday. So
it's the real motion.
Yeah, what's the real motion? It's at the end of our memo on
yes.
page.
So the motion.
Seven.
Yeah. The motion.
February
6th. Does two things. One, it approves the affordable housing tax credit. Do you want me to read it, or do you want me to just describe what it says?
Why don't we have somebody read it so it's moved, and then we, but not you. And so, Mr. Steinberg, you got it right there in front of you?
I'd move that under the authority provided to the Select Board by statutes of 2015, Chapter 148, the Select Board vote to, one, approve an affordable housing tax incentive for Beacon Communities Development, LLC, for the development known as North Square at the Mill District, which is to be located in North Amherst on property referred to as 92 and 134 Montague Road, and as the development has been approved with conditions and waivers by the Zoning Board of Appeals, provided, however, that Beacon shall provide a satisfactory permanent affordable housing restriction as defined under General Laws, Chapter 184, Section 31, to the town, as is required under Statutes 2015, Chapter 148, Section 3, before any tax relief granted hereunder shall become effective, and two, further direct that the town manager shall develop an affordable housing tax incentive agreement with Beacon Communities Development, LLC, or its successor or assign, in accordance with the financial terms set forth in the town manager's February 5, 2017 memorandum, a copy of which is attached hereto. Such tax incentives shall only apply to the residential portion of the development and will not be applied to the commercial portion of the development.
Second.
Say the sixth. One correction.
Oh.
As a typo, it should be February 6th, 2017.
Okay.
It's a Sunday.
Yes.
Right. And so we made that correction.
And
we
have a suggestion.
I would note that the after the first mention of Beacon Communities Development LLC to add or its successors and or assign, because as far as the entity that will own the development will be a special purpose entity. It might just be best to cover that as well there. I know it's listed below, but
where should it also be listed?
In the third line,
after
the word LLC.
Each time it says Beacon Communities Development LLC. Yep.
Okay. So I will propose those two amendments as noted, the change in the date and the addition of the or its successor or sign after the word LLC in the third line.
And seconders agree.
Yeah, excellent. And I would just like us to double check, this is completely too boring for you, but in the first line, the ST period 2015, we never refer to it that way anyplace else in town government. So they refer to the acts of 1995, so ST doesn't mean anything.
And that's for our own statute.
Yeah, that's referring to the special legislation. Mm-hmm. So it was Chapter 148 of the Acts of 2015 taken by the state, as opposed to by ST period 2015. There might be some other slight variation that council was looking at. I mean, maybe council uses it that way, but when we talk about it in our...
That's not my wording, this council's wording.
I appreciate that, but they sometimes forget that our community refers to things different ways.
It is actually a citation to session laws of the Massachusetts legislature, and I think that probably both are appropriate citation.
Maybe put it in parentheses if we want to be more comfortable, because if ST 2015 is what some people are going to be looking for, but anybody who's Googling it is more likely to be looking for the Acts of 2015. When we talk about it in our Town Government Act, it talks about various chapters of the Acts of various years.
So, it will, in parentheses, after the ST period 2015, comma, C period 148, you'll say parentheses, chapter 148 of the Acts of 2015.
Yes. Thank you. That way we cover both the plain English version and the legal counsel version. That's helpful. Thank you. Thank you. And then that'll repeat down in the middle. Mm-hmm.
Excellent. So we have two parenthetical additions where it says chapters 148 of the Acts of 2015, one edition of or its successors or assigned, and then the changing the date from February 5 to February 6.
Yes. I think the since it's parenthetical on the or its successor or assigned, it should be parenthetical.
Yes.
As well, for consistency, if nothing else, right?
Right. Was there anyone here from the public who had was planning to speak during this item? Because that's one of the things I do as a public comment. I say if it's on the agenda, then you can't speak during public comment. You can speak during the agenda item. So is there anyone from the public not affiliated with this? Okay. Then I see at least one. Good. And then after that, I will also turn back to any of the representatives that are here for this particular agenda item and see if you wanted to make a brief comment. But yes, member of the public, please come forward. You waited all this time. I saw you in the hallway hours ago.
Well, thank you, Madam Chairman. It seems to me that you have moved so quickly in here and done so much that I'm not sure that anything that I had intended to say will make any difference in what's going on. Maybe I will add a little bit of levity to the...
Don't forget to introduce yourself, even though we know who you are.
Everyone should.
My name is John Ulver. I live at 1333 West Street, Amherst. And I might add just a little levity to the process this evening. This is the first time I've lived in Amherst for 55 years, and 44 of those years were spent in the Massachusetts legislature and then the Congress of the United States. And this is the first time that I have appeared before this august body as a petitioner, in essence, and much of what I have was going to say is now irrelevant, really, because you've moved on so quickly. I did send letters to the Zoning Board of Appeals and a copy to Madam Chairman, you. Yep. A couple of weeks ago.
Yes, thank you.
And I had made 6 copies. I didn't realize that I had. No, you're going to handle them.
Ms. Kruger's
going
to.
I was supposed to give them to.
I told him, Mr. Steinberg.
To Steinberg. in case anybody thought that they would be, they might get some amusement out of reading them now after all the work has been done. In each of these, the second one is a op-ed, a guest column in the bulletin, which was printed on Friday, this just following Friday. I thought all the work would have been done before that, but and it does seem to have been done quite quickly. All right, in my comments there, the letter, you'll see that I've given fairly high marks, very high marks, to the carefully listening and planning and vetting process that the landowner, W.D. Coles, and the Beacon Community Development Team, and the town committees, all the town committees of jurisdiction have followed in this whole process over the past year and more.
And you all know, as I now recognize, that the town has had drafted the petition for a home rule action by the legislature. Our very good representatives, Senator Stan and Ellen, and Representative Ellen, moved that process along to its completion. That the incentive that is now available to the town of Amherst under that home rule petition in its lawful form has not yet been used, and that there is a request for the use of that petition here at this time. So all of that I don't have to say anything more about. I simply want to urge the board to approve the request to use the real estate tax incentive tool in this instance. I am confident that would produce a double win for the town of Amherst. The first win is that the fairly urgently needed housing and commercial development in the North Village Center. More than $40 million investment by one of the most reliable developers in Massachusetts, one that has been used by Amherst in dealing with the Rolling Green program to the gain of the community as a whole. And win number two is that will set a high standard example for future other proposed projects for our other village centers. And that, I think, is equally important. And I leave it to you to make your decision.
Thank you, and thank you very much for providing these letters to us, in addition to having sent them to us before, and for waiting this long to talk to us. We appreciate that too, and I appreciate the examples you gave of Beacons. We keep talking about Rolling Green here, but you also, as you point out here, other local communities as well that Beacons has worked well with. So
They have a huge investment in Massachusetts. There are at least 80 projects, I think, in at least 50 communities in the state of Massachusetts, covering about 12,000 managed units that they have developed. They are a very good developer that can be relied upon to produce what they promise to produce. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
No questions?
We should be grilling you at this point, right? Thank you very much.
Listen a little bit further.
Wonderful. Okay. At this point, I'm going to see if anyone else associated with the project, since I saw no other members of the public here with us at this time, who would like to make a remark. You're under no pressure to do so, but if you would like to make a statement, you are certainly welcome. I know that you've had a very long day and were before the ZBA earlier in this very room.
Good evening. Dara Covell with Beacon Communities, Honorable Chair, Select Board. Thanks for having us. That was a hard act to follow. I really should have let the honorable representative's words be the last, but I did want to get up here and say thank you. We've been working for over a year and a quarter on this project, from the first conversations about the site. But I mainly wanted to say that in all of Beacon's experience and my experience, we haven't had as positive a partnering with a town in a very long time as we've experienced here with your staff and your teams across the boards that we've worked with and within the town itself. And we're very grateful for the effort that was made. While it has been a good experience, it hasn't been an easy experience. It's been very intensive and rigorous. And your group of staff have really demonstrated a huge amount of professionalism and also problem solving and stick-to-itiveness to get us where we are today. So we're very grateful for that. Having wrapped up the ZBA process, we couldn't be happier having gotten through those seven hearings and are very pleased with the outcomes there. And we're now a week and a little away from submitting our big request to the state for funding. So. If all goes well, we'll be off to the races with that, and we are so excited to be working again with the town of Amherst and to bring you this, what we think is going to be just a stellar example of a project that we hope you can all be proud of in the many years going forward. So thank you.
Thank you very much. And in light of that, perhaps if we could just, Mr. Bachman, if you could indicate to us again, like so many things, this has been unfolding over the course of the day today as the ZBA, as she just referenced, approved the permit with conditions. One of the things we had talked about when we started talking about this in general terms is we said, well, depending on what the ZBA conditions are, that would seem to influence potentially what the trade-offs are. And so, given what happened hours ago today, but shortly after you wrote the rest of this memo, is there anything that we need to be aware of associated with that?
Well, I wasn't part of the meeting. Mr. Malloy was at the final meeting. Was there any changes that were made that we weren't aware of in their conditions?
No, I don't think so. Yeah. Nice try, Mr. Malloy.
Nate Malloy, senior planner. No, I think the ZBA did include about 130 conditions on the project. Nothing that would change it drastically. I think those conditions are to ensure a high quality development that was proposed. So, in terms of the site plan, design, even down to materials used, landscaping, all those standards were kept and maintained, and the applicant has agreed to that. So, I think that, the conditions really are just, to put that in writing and to capture what was presented at all the hearings. So I think what is presented is a high quality design with a good site plan and a lot of amenities. So it's things that, they don't necessarily have to do. So they include a dog run. They have, all utilities are going to be underground and in the buildings. They have resident amenities in the building. They are providing a mixed-use development, so there'll be attractions right there on site for both the residents and for neighbors. There's a pedestrian path to lead to the village center, so they have different ways of transportation. They'll help with a crosswalk across Cole, so the bus stop. They'll work with the town to submit a MassWorks application again in the future for any improvements up on that part of the village center in town. And I think just the overall aesthetics of the architecture. So they worked, they responded to concerns of community and the ZBA and of the Housing and Sheltering Committee and the trust to, go for a deeper level of affordability. I think originally it wasn't at that level, and their response was to, go for a more competitive project. And so I think that in itself is a, good attribute of the project.
Great. Thank you. That's very helpful. Ms. Krueger.
It is helpful. Could I just add one thing? They have also, Beacon Communities also has agreed to stay in dialogue with the Disability Access Advisory Committee and to provide accessible play equipment, or at least in part accessible. So that was something that had come up, I think, in one of our meetings, and it's always a set of recommendations or a group that we look to be included in making recommendations. And they did make comments, and the applicant was quite responsive to that. So just, had a long list there, and so I just wanted to add that one.
Right. Thank you. That's helpful. Other questions or comments? It's only 9:30.
Come on.
Mr. Wald.
I just wanted to reiterate some of what was said, but not quite the same thing, because we don't have that much time, but to thank Representative Older for his letter. I think there are two points that really stood out to me, and in that and his oral comments. Number one, there's the historical perspective from someone who's been involved in the town, watching the town grow and its master planning through the 1970s, and some of us were involved in a more recent process. And as Mr. Over points out, the master plan ideal was to develop village centers beyond the downtown, and to date, North Amherst is the only one in which nothing has happened. And we've all been through attempts to rezone North Amherst and to do projects there. And so something is finally happening in the area that he also calls a site the nearest thing to blight, which cannot be found in any other village centers in Amherst. You know, so this is really a major thing. And I think, as MBL stressed and Mr. Malloy stressed and Mr. Over stressed and the Representative Beacon stressed, you know, that the high quality of the project is very important too, because it sends a message that affordable housing doesn't have to be cheap and ugly. You know, we're taking this seriously. We're providing something that's good for all people with the amenities, the finishes, the response to design requests from the residents and so forth. So this is really important. And I know that a lot of people in North Amherst have had concerns about this project for all sorts of reasons, but we've heard the sort of concern about the future before with other projects that have gone up. You know, there was fear the sky would fall, the world would end, and there'd be all sorts of deleterious consequences. And so far, that hasn't been the case with our downtown projects, and I'm hoping and reasonably sure that will not be the case here either. So I think this is a step forward, and I hope we can all look forward to it and expect and find a positive result, and that the fears will prove to be unfounded.
Thank you. Mr. Steinberg.
Yeah. Following up also on Congressman Oliver's much appreciated comments. In prior times, when it was sort of you were on the other side of the table from me and I was coming to you to ask for something, it was usually about recognizing the needs of low-income people. And one of the major needs that I and my colleagues would often talk about is the need for affordable housing. And you were always very responsive to those conversations. And in that vein, I want to just recognize that this has been a magnificent team effort by a lot of people to try and do something for increasing not just affordable housing, but affordable housing with a very favorable income limits and for prospective tenants. And, you know, we're in the fortunate position as we sit here to recognize that, yes, we are offering something in a tax incentive, but as was pointed out, I think, in Mr. Bachelman's memorandum, it is funds that are really not anything that's coming from the budget, because if we didn't approve it, the funds wouldn't be collected anyway. So this is really, from my perspective, the possibility of a win for low-income people and a win for the town of Amherst in being able to do this without an actual expenditure of funds that we've collected in taxes. And actually, we know that it will increase taxation on the property, and now and much more in the future. But it is ultimately the right thing to do for the reason stated. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to also make sure we point out again our thanks to staff as well for all the material they've pulled together over the many months that this has been in development, but particularly over the last few weeks, as we know we've been looking toward this conversation, including the report about our subsidized housing inventory found in our packet online and previously provided to us in a slightly different format, and then a long list of various projects and what we've invested in them and what kind of funds we invested in them over the years. Because, you know, we've talked some about our investments in affordable housing over the years, and that was covered also in the memo in terms of how much per unit, because it varies considerably, obviously, given the circumstances. There is not X formula for that for us here in town either, but it helped to place it into context of the investments we've made with CPA dollars
and block grant dollars. And so those two in particular are funds that people are familiar with us paying for affordable housing out of. And again, we're not expending any funds from that. That means we can do other housing things with those funds. And again, we are not gaining immediate tax benefit at this moment, but on the other hand, we wouldn't be getting it anyway. So yes, it does seem like a win-win-win all the way around in terms of maintaining the viability of our other funding sources like CPA and block grant for other housing projects as well. Mr. Slaughter, did you have anything? Okay, yes, Mr. Bachman.
I do want to take this opportunity to thank our staff, because an enormous amount of staff time went into this project, both at the ZBA level and the principal assessor and the town manager staff, to think about the project at the ZBA level and to ask the critical questions and gather the information needed so the ZBA could make an informed decision. And then for this tax incentive, I really want to commend Mr. Burgess for being the person who helped. This is the first time we really thought about this, and Joel Bard was helpful to us because he was there at the crafting of it as we struggled with this. So I think that because we really needed to understand how this tool could be used for a project like this. And so Mr. Burgess was, every time he would suggest something, we would sort of circle around, talk to consultants, and come back usually where he had said something in the first place. So he had his knowledge of the town was very powerful. Also, Mr. Graham and Mr. Lucas took this on at a very challenging time for them, and they were able to turn around the analysis very, very effectively. And we really thank you for putting the effort into that. And again, the applicant was always willing to give us the information that we needed to do the proper analysis to serve you well. So thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Krueger.
I also want to thank our town manager, because this is kind of a daunting thing as a manager to look at all the pieces and then be asked to make a recommendation about something new and untried that involves a fair amount of money. So thank you as well, because I think you also approach this in a very serious and thorough manner, and I think you brought us to a place where we're able to make a responsible decision. I also, because I was fortunate to be able to attend all seven meetings, our ZBA, I thought, was exemplary in it, not what the outcome was or whether the decision was one I wanted or didn't want, but their process was really fantastic. And also to mention, counsel provided by Alana Cork from KP Law was really gave great guidance to the staff and to our ZBA as well. And just a final note, because I know my colleagues probably want me to shut up now. The way I look at just specifically the tax incentive, and I've been thinking about this for a while, in line with the question I asked Mr. Graham, I think it's really important for us to make sure that this project is successful. I think the way that it serves the town well is if it happens and if it's financially viable. And I truly believe that this component is part of making sure that this project goes forward the way it's designed and is successful. And I kind of think of it as, this is our equity share. We're partners with Beacon Communities in striving for a successful, high-quality development. So the request is a little bit above $2.7 million in deferred taxes. We've already talked about we wouldn't have them if we didn't do this. But I think that's our local investment in something that we've said we wanted to see happen, and it's in all of our interests, including the residents of North Amherst, to make sure that as this begins and goes into construction, that it is viable and successful. So I have found this a really kind of exhilarating process, sometimes a little daunting, but I'm very proud of all aspects of the town and how we worked our way through something that's very difficult, and I hope that the citizens understand the kind of thoughtfulness we've brought to this process.
Thank you very much. We can speak later of the fact that the town manager had to undertake this project and he hasn't even been here 6 months yet. So I'm setting the bar kind of high for yourself there. But we do really appreciate how everyone came together. And I'm thinking that we should, speaking of logistics type things, especially since the press has already left and was only here for part of this anyway, we should probably put out a press release about that. That sounds sensible. Which then causes me to say, so Mr. Bachelman, you want to write that base for me?
We can pull it off.
Yeah, exactly. We'll pull pieces out of your memo. And also, I really, especially when you were making your statement about our equity share, that was what really struck me as press release material. So that would be, that's right. You can send it over to Ms. Kruger. And that would be really helpful to make it really clear what we did tonight, because it is a project we're all extremely proud of. You know, we say over and over again that we need affordable housing, but it's not
I guess it's not really.
So if someone would please make the motion on the bottom of our motion sheet for all the various one-day liquor licenses, that would be helpful.
I will.
Okay, someone who's not chewing.
I move to approve the applications of the Top of the Campus Incorporated for special licenses to serve all alcohol at the 1. Eisenberg School of Management Atrium for a reception for Women of Eisenberg Conference on Friday, February 24, 2017, from 5 p.m. to 10 p.m. Kimberly McAllister, Director. 2. Lower level of W.E.B. Du Bois Library for a reception on Saturday, April 1, 2017, from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. Kimberly McAllister, Director. 3. Integrative Learning Center, first and second floor lobbies and patio area for a reception on Wednesday, May 11, 2017, from 5 p.m. to 10 p.m. Kimberly McAllister, Director. 4. Old Chapel for a reception slash dinner on Thursday, April 13, 2017, from 3 p.m. to 11 p.m. Jenny Lynn Fontaine, Director.
Second. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Excellent. Thank you. That passes unanimously. We also have an appointment. Ms. Kruger and Mr. Wald, would you like to read that, assuming that it came from one of you?
I move to appoint Bruce Carson to the Transportation Advisory Committee through June 30th, 2019.
Second.
Any further discussion? Does this leave any? Go ahead.
As you might recall, this is one of our newest committees, the Transportation Advisory Committee. And soon after we made the appointments, a member stepped off, so that left a vacancy. And Mr. Carson has had served for many years on the Amherst Planning Board and had come off of that service, completing a term July 1st. So he came and sat in on one of the TAC meetings and then was interested in and submitted his citizen activity form. But I was on the planning board with Mr. Carson and can say that he is very knowledgeable, very kind of sensitive to transportation issues as a longtime bicyclist. And just understands a lot of the planning issues in our community, and I think he would be an admirable member.
And the fact that retiring from planning board service doesn't mean he's refusing to ever do anything for us again is quite impressive as well.
Signing right up again.
Exactly.
It.
Mm-hmm. So, all those, any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 And that passes unanimously, and thank you to Mr. Carson for that. Okay, so now we still have, it's a preview for all of you still watching at home, town manager's report, select board member reports, and we still have under our action and discussion items a couple of things. One is item F, the town manager's FY18 budget proposal, which was presented to us on January 12th of 2017 in conformance with the Amherst Town Government Act. We always carry this questions and updates item. Is there anything new you'd like to tell us about the budget?
No, ma'am.
All right. Did anyone have any questions they forgot to ask Mr. Bachelman ahead of time and are going to ask him now as a surprise?
Okay, no then, excellent. And we will continue to carry that forward. And then the other action and discussion item still left here is annual town meeting preparation bylaw changes, first look, and it's going to be maybe half of a look at this point, but we do have material in our packet. Thank you to Ms. Pupple for help for pulling all that together. We have some committees that we just make up out of whole cloth here at Select Board, and we have other committees that have been established through town bylaws, which is through town meeting, and we have others that are town meeting action that are not town bylaws. So we have a whole variety of ways of establishing committees. Public Works Committee and Public Transportation, Bicycle, and Pedestrian Committee, which has still got the wrong acronym on it on this agenda, are two of the committees that we folded into the Transportation Advisory Committee, the one that we just made another appointment to. So we can't just say, oh, we don't have those anymore, and just like throw that piece of paper away. We have to do something to finish them. And if it had just been made up by Select Board, we could have said, well, that committee's dismissed, similarly to what we did to Cable Advisory Committee. When their work was completed, and what we might eventually end up doing for Downtown Parking Working Group. However, Public Works Committee is a town bylaw committee, and Public Transportation, Bicycle, and Pedestrian Committee is a town meeting action committee. So the reason you have those materials in front of you is because at some point we are going to ask council to put together an appropriate motion to divest the bylaw and of this particular section, and then also to ask us what the right wording is to say, thank you, town meeting, but this work is done because it's now in this other committee. And we will have those before us at annual town meeting. So this is basically a preview. And if any of you are particularly interested in how that's going to work, please let me know, because we could use additional eyes on that as time goes forward. The other one that's a little more complicated is the regulation of signs, which is from annual town meeting of, yes, March 20th, 1939, Article 12. And we, in fact, no longer have any town meeting members who remember that article. So it is about regulation of signs by the Select Board. And again, this is in your packets for everyone following along at home. It refers to very much bygone days in terms of how political signage works. And so this is about political signs. This is not about signs on businesses. This is something that we have not used in decades to anyone's recollection. We need to get rid of it, however, because every so often, a brand new person running for some sort of office asks us how to go about getting a permit under this section, and since we don't actually use this section, it's just a waste of everyone's time to have that conversation. So we are going to have larger conversations about signage. We've seen us talk with Building Commissioner Mora associated with other signage issues, Planning Department with other signing issues, but this piece seems to be something we can carve off separately as being Select Board regulation of political signs, or as is currently the case, not. So we are assuming that we will want to still stay with our current policy and practice, which is that, for example, no one puts signs on the common, no one puts signs on Kendrick Park, and that if they do, DPW picks them up. But at the same time, we aren't living in 1939 anymore. The landscape is literally and figuratively much different for political signage, and so the regulations that made sense back then do not seem to apply now. So that, again, is something that we would be looking at removing from the town bylaws.
Yes, just to be clear, I think you're talking about the general bylaws, not the zoning.
Right.
Bylaw, just yeah, so absolutely. People who are listening know. And
zoning
bylaws, I'm not going to
completely separate
totally
signage issue.
Venture into this realm, but maybe when we work with council or the other, or maybe Mr. Moore, we could find out that probably the bylaw, we're not enforcing it because I don't think it is probably legal no longer legal because of protected speech and other things. I think
But it also refers to the public way, which we do control.
That part, yes.
Some
but I think, I'm not going to venture, but I think one reason it's not our practice is I don't think, well, we can or certainly not should enforce the part you're talking about, which is getting our permission to put up like only five
right.
campaign
it
signs
makes,
or whatever
no
that
sense.
Is. And it is outdated, very much so.
So if you have thoughts about, please, Mr. Slaughter.
Just one quick thing. My quick read of this is that sections 1 and 2 relate to all signs and not just political signs. It's only from 3 on that are political.
So that's not supposed to be the case.
I mean, I have to look.
I'm just asking a question. Should vet that as
you're
part
right.
and parcel
the,
of the process.
So the
that's all I'm
part,
saying.
The first two parts are the parts that are probably more related to what Ms. Kruger referenced earlier,
exactly.
which is the fact that we know there are all these different rules out there now
right.
about what you're allowed to control and what you aren't allowed to control in terms of content. And
right.
so that part of it may need to stay until Mr. Moore is comfortable with where, and the planning department is comfortable with where we are going with that. But again, this is out of the general bylaw as opposed to the zoning bylaw, and so figuring out how those pieces mesh together, et cetera, et cetera. I do not believe, in fact, I can guarantee you that we are not doing, for example, 2 doesn't talk about political signs, but it still talks about permits from the selectmen, which don't exist.
Right.
We don't provide those. And so we need to go through this and figure it out. And so my point in bringing this to you now is that, of course, it won't be much longer before it's really time to be talking about town meeting. But the other issue of it is if anyone's working, for example, on the other issues associated with signage,
right.
talking about the other things we're talking about, to make sure that, you know, we don't need to conflict with each other as to what we're attempting to accomplish here. But we do want to remove the part about political signs and while still protecting, as we said, things like our commons. So figuring out a good way to do that, if anybody thinks, wow, I have some free time, I would love to work on this particular issue, please feel free to let me know. Otherwise, we'll see what I guess we can do with it associated with staff and their understanding of our situation. But then we are going to need to take some responsibility for this because, you know, it says select and we're not actually doing it, and we don't seem to have any intention of providing permits associated with advertising displays. That must surely be covered somewhere else. The part where it says that it's talking about permits from the selectmen, there must be other places in our in the zoning bylaw that talks about
the signing,
advertising
the sign
displays, et cetera.
The section of the zoning bylaw is what governs.
Yes. Probably, I'm guessing, this predated that section of the zoning bylaw.
Almost guaranteed.
If we had zoning in it.
If we had any zoning in 1939, it wasn't that specific,
you're
probably.
You're actively not enforcing
yes.
the bylaw.
Exactly. And we are certainly, and so we will see what we can do about cleaning that up. And so, again, looking for volunteers to help with doing that rather than trying to just simply say, so, Mr. Bachman, can you find us another staff member to work on that? And then saying, oh, no, that's not what we meant. So that, you know, we have some clarity moving along with that.
I thought this was one of your pet projects.
This is one of my pet projects, but I'm eager to have anybody else participate
you'd
that would like.
You'd be the best person.
Oh, well, thank you so much. I will take that as a compliment.
How do we determine what we want without deliberating? So I leave it at that.
Well, we're going to have a proposal come forward that marks things out because that will be, and then when we will vet it all here in public with appropriately posted items on the agenda so that by the time we get to town meeting, we don't have people saying, but what about sentence 2 that's lined through, but bold, but italic, but what are we doing? Hopefully we can get it to the point where it will be clear what we are trying to accomplish. So that's kind of a on hold and to be acted upon later. Moving on. Other items tonight. We have a calendar preview in that Saturday morning. We have a 4 towns meeting at 9 a.m. And we then have the Black History Month flag raising at 11 a.m. And it's also the day of Winterfest. And so all those things are happening this coming Saturday. In terms of other issues, I'm going to move to select board member reports now, and then I'm going to flip to town manager. We're going to let him close out the evening, and we can ask him questions about things that he might not have thought we needed to know. So questions or comments from the select board in regards to various meetings you've been to, things you've been doing.
So the PVTA advisory board, well, it didn't technically meet because they had not had a quorum and dismissed before I arrived, so I actually was the cause of that. But nonetheless, I felt badly. I've been.
You got to drive all the way to Springfield.
I was in Springfield and got hung up at something, and they waited as long as they could. But then I got there like as I saw my colleagues passing me in the parking lot.
Bummer.
But anyway, separate from that, they will. There was no urgent actionable items that they needed, but the one piece of information from that meeting in quotes was that the administrator Mary McInnes has submitted her 90-day notice. You may have seen it in the newspaper, but she submitted her 90-day notice. It's not a surprise. She had told our former town manager when he was serving as the chair of the advisory board that she would, you know, stick around until some capital projects were well underway, and that's currently where she's at. The funding is largely secured for the several capital projects that are underway, and they're, you know, some are finishing up and some are, you know, getting rolling, and so she will be she'll be missed because she's a superb administrator and is extraordinarily knowledgeable in the transportation field, and we've been lucky to have her. The advisory board will probably form a committee of its members, and I'm not sure if they're going to consider outside people, but to go through the process of finding her replacement. She will be there into April and has, you know, generously offered to help advise on the selection of the next person and provide support for that new person as they come on board and get up to speed on the PVTA. So that's the big news out of that advisory board to the PVTA.
Thank you. Any other?
EdCom meets tomorrow night. They've got lots of stuff on their agenda, so I'm hoping they actually don't get snowed out and have a quorum.
Excellent. Mr. Steinberg.
Yeah, the only thing is just to follow up on the calendar preview item, I really encourage all of my colleagues here to be at the Four Towns meeting. I think that it's going to be a very difficult discussion and that it's important that we all are there to advance the interests of both the regional schools and our town. I think that, in essence, they're going to be two different budget proposals that are tied to proposals for allocation of the assessments. And one of them is a reasonable resolution that I think that serves the interest that I talked about. I think that the other resolution that may be pushed by one particular town, not to be named here at this meeting, is one that would not be favorable either to the long-term interests of our financial security in Amherst, but also to the financial security of our regional schools. And given the import of this discussion, which is going to have to provide input to the regional school committee, but then has to ultimately come back to all four town meetings in the four member towns, I think it's particularly important that we be very strong in our assessment of this. So that's the quickest I can do of the topic.
Is there anything in particular you want us to be thinking about? I know that you've been representing us on any variety of various assessment working group discussions associated with this and working individually with various people. So,
well, I'll most specifically say that if a proposal is made, and I would not be surprised that it is made, though I'm trying to talk to some people in another town to see if I can get some reason before Saturday, to revert to the default formula for that's built into the education laws of the Commonwealth. That formula, because a lot of it is based upon the EQV assigned to each of the towns, and because of development, as we've talked about tonight and otherwise, our EQV may be going up at a greater rate than other towns' EQVs is going up, which is the total of the property values, as you know. And so the I think it's a reasonable assumption for a formula that nobody can really understand and therefore can't say with 100% certainty, but it's a reasonable presumption that that would put a squeeze on our future budgets to the point that we would just have to be sending out strong signals that there needed to be a cap, because our cap would have to be then factored into that particular formula. The net result would be, to achieve that cap, the regional schools would have to make some substantial and devastating reductions to future budgets. And I think that's the issue to in particular be aware of.
Thank you. That's helpful. Mr. Bachman, would you check and see if that meeting is specifically posted as a select board meeting? With four towns meetings, we don't really need to. We do it because it's clear in the posting that select boards, school committees, finance committees are all meeting. But just to be extra sure, we normally like to post it as our own meeting, because we will definitely have a quorum there. And again, we're allowed to have a quorum at another mm-hmm. meeting, but just because, in fact, this one might require even more discussion with each other than just the listening part.
Yes. Take an action.
Yeah, that would be great.
Yes. In the order of reports, I did attend the zoning subcommittee, the planning board's meeting last week, and just kind of a little preview of some things that might be coming forward for town meeting, in addition to the things that we've listed as sort of ours. But they were looking at amending or making a change to the bylaw that would allow for single room occupancy housing in a more flexible manner, because it's one of the housing needs that has been articulated greatly by some of the housing committees, and there's a glitch in the way our bylaws that might be an inhibitor, and maybe an unintended one. They were talking about amendments to a footnote 3. I don't remember what that one was, but I have paperwork at home. And then I wanted to let you know that February 28th, there's a joint meeting of the Downtown Parking Working Group and the Planning Board at 7 p.m. to talk about the municipal parking district, and that's it's on the agenda for tomorrow for the Downtown Parking Working Group to get some background, and then this joint meeting that the Planning Board had requested. So that's, you know, something that's come up repeatedly around downtown development and parking needs. So I think that'll be interesting. There isn't a particular solution on the table or something like that. And then also, and I think you received a citizen petition article for rezoning parcels in North Amherst that we'll be able to review and comment on should we want to prior to town meeting. I think that's it. I'm trying to remember what other meetings, but
thank you for reminding us of that. We did get that citizen zoning petition article, and we do normally vote to send that over to the planning board. And we
oh, right.
Do that. And so, although I'm sure they have it, we should go ahead and officially do that at our meeting of the 13th. The law doesn't seem to say, you know, you have to vote to do it. It just says we have to send it, but we don't really know how to send it if we don't vote to do it. So it's kind of like, yeah, we sent it. There it is. That would be helpful. Given the deadlines for town meeting, which is coming right up at the end of February, beginning of March, do you think that there's going to be any, given that they're only meeting jointly on the February 28th, there is not at this point, like, they're coming to that with a proposal of we're going to take this to town meeting in the spring?
It's not like they have someone's drafted a text for it, but then maybe by the time the joint meeting, I don't really know, but good question. And I'll need to remind them of those deadlines, which I have somewhere.
Because the staff and committee list of warrant articles due is 2:28 at noon, so that's before they meet. So they have something that's coming right up.
Well, we're speaking of dates. I think these dates are already gone by. You changed a bunch of them when you go further down. The meeting of April 10th, we changed to the 12th because of Passover?
Actually didn't yet vote to change it.
Okay, but just so that these dates, happen. All right, okay.
So it should be, and in fact, that's something that should have been on our motion sheet tonight, but in all the other
but I just wanted,
breaking news.
That's fine, but just to know that these are in flux.
Right.
Some of these are in flux.
We did get some feedback because it's purely a scheduling matter. So the only one that should be in flux at this point is, and we can talk about others in a moment, but when we said Monday, April 10th, so it wouldn't be the 10th, it wouldn't be the 11th, but that Wednesday the 12th worked for most people, as I recall. So I'm going to move that we change the date of the April 10th meeting to Wednesday, April 12th.
Second.
Is there any further discussion about that? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Change the date. Thank you, and that is unanimous of Monday 4:10 to Wednesday 4:12. Okay, and then was there another date that you were questioning? That
I thought we talked about the 24th. There was, in one of your scheduling emails, April 24th changing to the 19th, or did I imagine
No,
that?
The idea was, associated with that, was that if we couldn't meet the week of the 10th,
that
then we would
fallback?
Pick up a date the following week, if necessary. But since it looked like the 12th worked for people, then we didn't need to pick
We're
up
working
a date
at,
the
is April 3rd one of the, we are meeting April 3rd.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, great. All right, thank you. Yeah, okay, great.
Okay, so we've made that change, and we voted that change, and so that'll start to promulgate on various places where we keep track of such things. Okay, Mr. Wald.
So update on the local historic district question that went before the Historical Commission last week, and they voted to support the idea in principle. This is the one for Lincoln Sunset, so-called, which really stretches it down from basically Amity Street toward Kendrick Park from Pleasant Street, with some exceptions, westward. So the Historical Commission voted to support in principle with some questions about boundaries and the whole process behind it or the larger issues. Then the following night on Wednesday, the Planning Board, in a second night of deliberation, actually this was the deliberation they heard report a couple of weeks ago, they had a lot of questions also about both the principles of these things and about the boundaries, and one motion failed, and then the one that passed was to support this, however, removing the North Pleasant Street properties, which they felt were an issue and were complicated for a variety of reasons, either because they might be subject to new kinds of development or competing regulations, say from DRB, zoning bylaw, and this and so forth. So that was a 5-2 vote with two absent. So again, these are recommendations, but they help to shape our judgment of this. And one question that the Planning Board, I mentioned this because we're talking about town meeting, otherwise I wouldn't take your time at this hour. One of the questions the Planning Board had was maybe we should put it off until later because they're talking about a sort of downtown vision, how to develop the downtown and so forth. And that was left hanging. The study committee, I think, is inclined to go forward. But I think various parties are now satisfied that, we'll see what happens, but this idea of taking off those properties that are most contentious seems to be satisfying most people across the board. So then the question would be, assuming they have to go forward, when do they have to get this petition article ready? And so we can convey to them that date, because this would be from a town body, so February 28th is our operative date.
Yep.
Okay. I think that's all as far as the committee business, which is just bang, bang, bang last week, all four nights of meetings. I had one question about speaking of all this too, with the cable, for example, and the numerous emails we receive. It's of course very good that our office staff is so conscientious about sending a reply to everyone who writes to the town manager and the select board, but we were wondering, do we need to receive copies of all those, you know, because it does clog the inbox. And I mean, I think it's very important that Ms. Pupple informs us she's doing this, but maybe one could send out a note saying, here is my standard response, which will go to all people, so I get 500 as opposed to one email. I don't know, it's a lot of work for her and for everyone else to
to copy us all on each of those.
Right, and thank you. Ms. Pupple and I worked together to determine who's going to respond to what, and she has been very gracious about developing standard language for a couple of different issues. One was associated with the Beacon Tax Incentive Project, and the other was associated with the incredible deluge of emails we received about Amherst Media starting at the end of last week. So we can go ahead and advise her that in future, if she could just send us that when she and I agree, I will point out to her that it's fine with the select board if they don't get copied on everything since it's a stock answer, and that we can get the first one so that we know what has been said.
That's important.
And because, for example, she developed some of these, she develops out of entirely on her own, and they're always very helpful. So she can tell us what she's going to send is that one thing, but then she doesn't have to copy us on all the rest of them, because yes, our emails were extremely difficult to wade through starting at the end of last week between what was going in and what were the acknowledgments that are going back out and the huge amount of effort that she had to put in to get all of those sent back out to people. So thank you. I will bear that in mind myself as well when I since I tend to reply to the one-off sorts of things, you'll probably still get copies of those.
Please so. Make it stop.
Please make it stop. Yes. Okay.
Not the public is writing to us, which we always welcome.
I hear that.
Okay. Staff response.
Other reports from select board members at this point. Okay. So then I'm going to turn it over to the town manager.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The New England Patriots won the Super Bowl.
Oh, I'm so glad you let us know.
Is it? And the good news is that things were relatively calm on the University of Massachusetts campus. And I was able to be at the Emergency Operations Center that UMass had set up. I met Swami up there, and we had our people in place there as well. It's really not a lot of police involved, mostly extra firefighters. But there were only three ambulance calls. There were over 3,000 people gathered in the quad at Southwest. There were no arrests. There was one thing reported as an officer being assaulted in the newspaper. That was not an officer of ours. It was a security guard for one of the housing complexes. I think a lot of this is attributable. I was up there in the third quarter when we were losing by 25 points, and everybody's very happy because they're thinking it's just going to peter out. And they said the worst thing could be if the Patriots come back and win at the last minute, which is what happened.
Never
well prepared. They had they do all kinds of very interesting precautions. For instance, they have all the apartment complexes empty out the dumpsters on Friday and Saturday, so there's no big pieces of furniture or laying around, so that nobody gets tempted to start a fire. So they've learned all the tricks of the trade, and a lot of it is due to preparation. And the university police had a very good way of sort of let them have space for about 45 minutes, and then they sort of walk through and just, not in an aggressive way, but say, come on, guys, time to go home. And they pretty much dispersed. So a very successful evening. Our officers, we had extra officers on duty, and they mainly stayed in the Fearing Street area and to make sure people stayed on campus. Really not, when I talked to the to Captain Gunderson this morning, it was really not much of an issue for us. And I talked with the fire chief this morning as well. And again, not much. There's some ambulance calls, but for someone getting a laceration on the nose, things like that. There was a drug overdose of some sort. So very good. And I think people were generally happier. So there wasn't a lot of angst and no anything like that. But I think a lot of it has to do with preparation. The university took extra steps. You couldn't even stay at someone else's dorm if you weren't part of that dorm. So you had to stay in your own dorm and things like that. Earlier that day, I've been taking these early morning walks. So I was out for a walk and heard this big foghorn sound and from the center of town. I didn't know what it was. I thought, well, maybe I'm never up early enough to hear what this is. But it was as I continued to walk down East Pleasant Street, I suddenly saw the smoke billowing from at the intersection of Triangle and East Pleasant Street. And the fire had been going since about 5:15. I got there around 5:45, and they had just had to evacuate the firefighters from the building. It was interesting for me to be there to see you know, all three chiefs were on scene. Everybody had turned out. Tremendous work by our firefighters in extremely difficult conditions because it was very cold. They're wearing this heavy equipment, and they're going into the building, and then they had to withdraw them because they could see the fire taking a different shape. There's so much to firefighting science that I'm learning from our leaders over there. The interesting thing, though, that is it's not just the firefighters. It's a real team effort because first on the scene were our police officers, and they're able to assess the situation, you know, send a quick notice to the fire department that it's a real working fire, help get the residents out of the apartment. The residents were friends with the firefighter, and they were able to go to this firefighter's home very quickly. DPW was there because DPW has to be there for the to turn off the water and to gauge whether the water tank was being addressed. And so that's all being done at the same time. And then they brought in a truck for DPW because everything was icing up. So they sand and salt everything. So, you know, we have an amazing emergency response team. And so when you hear about a fire, it's not just the fire. It's also the police who are controlling the situation. It's the DPW who are doing all different things to help out. And it's the firefighters. And it was just great to see at the very beginning how everybody worked together. Oh, and the building inspector was there because the building inspector has to go in to assess whether the building is habitable. So everybody gets this phone call.
The town manager was there.
The town manager happened to show up. I get a phone call, but those are people who matter, and they had jobs to do. And the building inspector was interesting because he likes to get there early while the fire department controls the scene, so he can really get in and assess the situation. Once they lose control of the scene, he has to get more of a warrant to go in. So it's kind of an interesting thing. And I really was feeling for the firefighters because I knew that night they were supposed to be back on duty at 8 p.m. to 8 to midnight because we had extra people on duty. And so they were going to be exhausted that day. So kudos to our firefighters for being such a great asset for the community. A few other things. You mentioned the one zoning article. The winter parking pilot is in place, and we haven't heard much about it. It seems to be, we haven't had much snow, so we will be tested, I think, maybe tomorrow. The plastic bag ban, the Board of Health and our Economic Development Director are working on doing publicity on that. You saw that there's a ribbon cutting. You should have gotten an invitation to the ribbon cutting for the old chapel at UMass on February 13th. You have a thing in your packet about MMA's legislative breakfast. It's free to sign up. Mr. Mooring attended the Waste Reduction Enforcement Coordinator Grant information meeting. And the next step on that is if we want to pursue that, which we're still not sure, we have until the end of the month to submit a plan of action. Enforcement is definitely part of the grant. I want to see what he comes up with in terms of his vision. He knows that there's not a lot of interest in having people's individual trash bins being sorted through, but he's trying to think of a way to work with the trash hauling companies because they have a vested interest as well. And then he also wants to think through the biggest culprit are the apartment complexes, to make sure that there are recycling facilities available to people. And that's where we think the biggest issue is. We have received a $5,000 Mass Cultural Council grant for someone to work with the Business Improvement District. It needs to be matched by $5,000 from the Business Improvement District, so I'm waiting. I'm not signing the grant until I see a plan of action from the bid on how they're going to come up with that $5,000, because I don't want to say yes to a grant that we can't match. I attended the Business Improvement District meeting last Friday. A few things that you might hear about there. The spring's plantings are going to focus on the new parking lot across from the library. They are very actively looking at wayfinding signs, and there's an RFP out that we are reviewing in Town Hall at this point. And then they are pursuing the band shell on the common. And interesting, what I learned is that they've pretty much settled on a modern design, not a old band shell. And that's basically, they said from the historical commission, they said, don't try and replicate what might have been there at one point, because nothing ever did. But utilize a more modern design. So that was a good thing. We are doing a lot of research on new parking meters, not the individual parking meters, but the big ones in the lots, because everybody has so much frustration with them. The Downtown Parking Working Group is doing work on that, and our treasurer is also doing that. Last Friday, I signed the letter to MSBA in anticipation of an action. I knew it had to go out today. Superintendent Morris had prepared it. I was prepared to sign it because the information I had was whatever the last town meeting had acted on. But the thing that we learned is that it needed all three signatures. It needed my signature, it needed the superintendent's signature, and it needed the chair of the school committee's signature. Without any one of those signatures, it would not be a valid letter. So I know the school committee was meeting tonight on that issue. And along those same lines, we've received a large number of petitions to our office, which have been sent down to the clerk's office to be reviewed. We've received a quick count, 1,754 signatures today before the close of business. There were about, according to the town clerk, the threshold was 829 signatures, plus she will have a percentage on how many more she'll want to certify in terms of valid signatures. So that will be call for a referendum that will put the question of the fund borrowing for the two schools co-located at the Wildwood site onto a ballot, onto a separate ballot at an election that you will be required to call in a reasonable time frame. And one last thing, because I know you'll want
to
talk about
that. We'll
come back to that. Yeah. Mr. Zomek will be in the seat next week, just so you're aware of that. That concludes my report.
Moving back to the very beginning, thank you for all of these updates. But in particular, I appreciate that you appreciated that we appreciate UMass for taking the measures, for example, on the residence hall visitation. That was something that came up in the Ed Davis report and has been used in a variety of different ways since then. And we really appreciate that. We know that's extra work for them and that that's a communication effort they have to make and possible frustration on some of their students' parts. So we appreciate that they did that. One of the other questions I had, and I believe you'd indicated that we largely were keeping sort of redirecting people to stay on campus. Was townhouse an issue?
There was a gathering at townhouse, but when we sent officers up there, it was a relatively small group of people, and people who were going there saw that there wasn't much going on and left.
Wasn't worth hanging out? Yeah. All right. We'll take
that. That's
what
I was told, at least, so.
Okay, good. We're going to come back to the referendum question. Were there other questions about other things on the town manager's report, or that it piqued you, reminded you to ask him about something else? Okay, great. So in terms of the grant follow-ups, this is going to get a little tight on time for us, just in terms of, just so we know what's happening, not because we get to decide, but the Cultural Council, I appreciate that you said, you know, you're waiting to hear what the bids matching plan is associated with that, and the one that we have spent a little more time on, which is the waste reduction enforcement coordinator position. And so I guess we'll want a sense of what you're planning to do associated with that, since that will eventually be part of, if you decide to do it, part of the budget recommendation, right, which it's not currently in the budget, and it would need to be in addition to that, and for us to think about our support or not for that particular position. So we'll be looking at trying to do that, because as you indicated, the end of the month is when they expect you to respond on that, and that would mean we basically have meetings on the 13th and the 27th, and this being February, that would be the next day, the 28th probably. Okay, so Mr. Wald.
The bid grant, is that the cultural district grant you're referring to?
Yes. Yes.
Through the bid, but it's for the cultural.
It's through the town, actually, but the bid it was the one that really initiated it. Yeah.
Just want to clarify for the public.
Yes.
So the bid initiated, and the bid has to come up with money for it before we can examine this.
Well, the contract reads that it's the town's grant. It comes to the town, and that the town promises to raise the match, and we're not raising the match. The bid is.
Okay.
All right, even though, of course, we're part of the bid, but yes. Okay, thank
and
you.
And we pay our dues as part of
that's right. We do. We do. Or we are full participants. Okay. Something that's just on our desk that I knew that I was going to forget about, and I had extra copies made tonight, and I'm going to send these back up with you, Mr. Bachelman, so you can take them upstairs maybe, and then people will have them available. Maybe we'll leave some at the planning desk out here. There is a meeting on this Thursday here in the town room, in town hall, regarding the intersection improvements and related work on Routes 9 and 116 from University Drive to South Pleasant Street. So there's a whole bunch of information here that was already on the front page of the town website, but since we got all this additional information that was sent to the planning department, that's also thanks to staff, again, doing things at the last minute for us, you know, being asked in a hurry to do something. They went ahead and put all this up today so people could see it and be aware of it and know to show up at that hearing. I don't know, given all of our schedules, whether it's likely any of us are going to be going to that, but that's happening here on Thursday. So again, we'll leave copies of that around for people to take a look at. In terms of the referendum, so it's my understanding in terms of late breaking news that the school committee voted 4-1 to not withdraw the application. So that would mean that signature question was moot because they were not intending to have their chair or the superintendent sign it, because they are working under the assumption that given the numbers of signatures that you just gave us and the threshold that there will be enough. And it was pointed out to us when this whole discussion started that in fact town meeting actions are not in fact actually effective until 5 days after because of this referendum. And so it would have been a little weird to send the letter before the 5 days was up anyway. We hadn't thought that part of it through in terms of great detail, because even though we don't deal with referendums very often, they aren't in fact part of our town government act. So, and given all that, and that we've received guidance from town council that we need to have a special election, as it says in our town government act, but that it can be held at the same time as our regular election, given that this is already February and our election's on March 28th, it appears that the most obvious thing to do is to have a separate ballot with just this question on it, and then also have our separate ballot that has our town offices on it. And there'll be two ballots, so that will be not, that's always a challenge for the town clerk's office to manage, but it seems like less of one than trying to have another as soon as practicable election between now and then. And we have until March 31st in terms of the extension with the MSBA, so that's why March 28th would make sense.
So just to follow on that, the authorization for the debt override exclusion was on November 8th, was the election day. That is valid, I believe, which is separate from, you know, the contract with the MSBA and that sort of thing. But my understanding, and I could be incorrect in this, from the conversation I had at Joint Capital Planning Committee, was that that authorization is good for 120 days. And if that's the case, then that would fall before the end of March, I believe. But we should check that fact. I don't know if I have that right or not. In other words, the authorization for debt exclusion override, if not act upon for the other piece, has a finite window, was my understanding.
We were never provided that information before, because if we had been, we would have discussed that when we were discussing when to schedule the election and when to schedule the town meeting action. So that is news.
And I could be wrong, but
I would hate to say I hope you are, but we will find out.
Well, it just drives right the question now. When the election would have to be, and when if this referendum question is to happen, it would drive when that would happen so as to fall within the time frame of the authorization of the override, if that's the case.
And this is in fact a critical question, because we only have until February 21st. Which is the day after a holiday, meaning we have until basically February 13th, our next meeting next week, to submit this question to the town clerk to be placed on the ballot for March 28th. Therefore, if it has to be prior to March 28th, then we really are running into a time crunch. So thank you for that.
Because there may
that
be ways
is not
to
a conversation I remember us ever having before, and it certainly was not explained to the population that, well, how would you, that the November 8th question on the override is only good for 120 days. How interesting. And is that true, whether it's a general operating override or just for debt exclusions?
Well, in that circumstance, I think you take whatever subsequent action relative to a general override. And I think they're just different animals, and so there's a different sort of set of rules. Because the thing that would happen is with a general override, you wouldn't set the tax rate until the following, you know, potentially like November or December relative to a March election. So you couldn't even take action on that override kind of question until much, much later. Whereas this is a specific authorization for a specific thing, you know, to pay a specific debt. And that's not to say you have to actually borrow the money, obviously, because that, but to have the authorization to borrow. But again, I could be mistaken. I may have misunderstood what was expressed to me, but it does complicate the timelines.
Yes, especially given that we were not able to provide this information to the people who came and asked us for language for the referendum. That would be unfortunate. Okay, Mr. Steinberg.
I'm right now taking a quick look at the Department of Revenue publication on overrides, and I don't see anything that pops out at me in a quick read, but I have to say that that's not definitive given the little bit of time that I've looked at it. I have never been familiar with that either. We do have another option, should that be true, because if this is going to pass by two-thirds vote, which is required for bond authorization, there would be the alternate question if we have to put another override on the ballot because this debt exclusion override expired, whether that's another option, so that as we explore, that's something to also add to that list.
Right. We wouldn't be allowed to put it on the special election ballot, but since conveniently we were already having election on March 28th, we could put that, the debt exclusion override question that was the same on November 8th, we could put it on the March 28th ballot if we had to.
So can I make a suggestion? Because yes. I know people are like trying to look stuff up, and we may not get a definitive answer tonight. So maybe the plan is how will the information get out to us to let us know the answer, and what steps would we need to take, and do we need to know? I mean, is the 13th when we meet again soon enough to resolve? Because I know we'll have the information by then, because otherwise we could keep kicking this one around for a while, and I don't know if we're going to be able to answer it tonight.
We were expecting that at the meeting of the 13th, when Mr. Zomack, not Mr. Brackelman, will be sitting there, we will have the language that was recommended by council to the petitioners for the referendum that we would place on the ballot, that we would send to the town clerk and say, this is the thing we want to have printed. But yeah. Okay, then, on the separate ballot, and we're also at next week's meeting supposed to be approving the warrant, as we always do when we say warrant, we tend to think of town meeting, but the warrant for the actual election is scheduled for next week as well. And obviously we just sign it because that's what we do. But if we need that extra day. So thank you for bringing up a brand new, exciting piece of information that we thought we had covered all possible bases, but there's always something new to be known. So we will find out what that reference was in regards to, and we will be able to hopefully reassure the public quite soon of what the next plan of action is, and if we do have to have an additional select board meeting between now and some point, Monday.
We will have
Saturday morning's meeting.
Saturday morning posted. We could take an action if we need to, as soon as then. So that's really not so bad.
That's a little improvement. It's Saturday to Monday. It's not a lot of improvement, but it's something.
Something extra in there.
Okay. So, and that could enable us to also sort of take us a little side part to the meeting, perhaps while others are caucusing too. Ensure where we are with that issue. So pardon me. So we will now, yes, well, let's go back to ending on a fine note. We are very excited about many of the things we've done this evening, according, especially the tax incentive project for Beacon. I don't want to end on a note of we don't know what the answer is to something. That's a terrible way to end a meeting.
The Patriots won the Super Bowl. You sort of trot that one out again, right?
Some happy things here that we can actually feel good about tonight when we go home, because we can't fix any questions about 120 days between now and tomorrow morning. So is there anything else that people wish to discuss? All right, then we can entertain that motion.
I move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye, and it's 10:42 p.m. and we are adjourned. Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much, Amherst Media, for sticking with us for so long. We're sorry it was a late meeting. Believe me, we're sorry. And so we will see everyone on the 13th. What is-